Microphones hot. Satellite link established. Studio lights illuminated. Cameras rolling. Audio and video encoders airing ones and zeros. Internet stream.
Streaming.
The most technology advanced radio show is on the air. Here's the captain of this enterprise, Steve Malzberg.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Steve Malzberg Show. Hearings. We had hearings today. The former head of the IRS, the former acting head of the IRS, although that's he was referred to in some news reports as the acting head of the IRS who's on his way out. I thought he's out. I thought he's done. I thought he was kicked out. I thought he's now the former head of the IRS. But nonetheless, Stephen Miller testified today and in front of Congress and in front of the House Ways and Means Committee. And I want to get right to what he had to say from his opening statement. Here's cut 37.
In the 3 years since she applied, beginning in December 2010, she was visited by the FBI Domestic Terrorism Unit.
That's not cut 37, obviously.
Her business returns.
Not his opening statement. But we'll try to get our act together here and bring you the opening statement. Here we go.
Mr. Miller, who in the IRS is responsible for targeting conservative organizations?
So let me first say I cannot speak to a given case. And that we've talked about 6103, but that's...
This is not just one case. You know we're talking about the whole list the Inspector General put up there.
Correct.
Who is responsible for targeting these groups?
So again, I'm going to take exception to the concept of targeting because it's a loaded term. The listing was done.
This was not a listing. You created a be on the lookout list.
Yeah.
That's not a centralized government mandated or directed listing. You had a be on the lookout list that you acknowledge. You have the cases the Inspector General already verified. So the question remains, who is responsible for targeting these conservative organizations?
All right, that wasn't the opening statement either, and it wasn't cut 37 either. So I don't know exactly who was doing the questioning there, ladies and gentlemen, but you heard the question to pose to Stephen Miller. So let's play the next cut in progression of whatever that was.
So again, and I think if you look at the TIGTA report, it answers your question.
There are no names in the Inspector General's report. So I'm asking you, not only as the acting commissioner, but as the deputy commissioner over this organization, who is responsible for targeting these individuals?
So I don't have names for you, Mr. Brady, and I'm willing to try to find that out. I think TIGTA is looking at that right now. I don't think targeting, again, is wrong.
You're telling us you have no knowledge of who initiated or who approved this targeting of conservative organizations.
I will stand by what the TIGTA report has put out there as the facts.
Can you?
All right, so that's a Congressman Kevin Brady of Texas, and you hear he has no names for us. Stephen Miller has no names for us of who initiated this targeting, who was responsible, who started it, who approved it, the going after the conservative groups. No names. He has no names for us. This is a man who said we were just overworked, you know, we were overwhelmed, there was no targeting. I take exception to the word targeting. Well, who instituted this? He was the acting director, and he has no idea. Let's go to the next cut and progression.
Can you assure this committee that none of the information provided to the IRS by these groups was shared or given to any other federal agency?
That would be a violation of law, and I do not believe that happens.
You can assure us there was absolutely no sharing of this information with other government agencies.
TIGTA and others will look at that, but I would be shocked, Congressman, if that happened. Shocked.
If your earlier answers are any indication, we will all read about it in the media. We ought to be getting the truth from you.
Okay. Good for Congressman Brady. He would be shocked. You know, stop feigning this nonsense. This guy is a clown, and he acted like a clown on the stand, in my opinion, today. Wasn't forthcoming, took offense to the word targeting because of the implications in the word targeting. I mean, who is he kidding? We found out nothing today except that we're not getting the information that we need to get. Now, do we have cut 37? Could we do it from the opening statement? I don't know what. All right, let's go to cut 37. Here's some of the opening statement from the former acting head, Mr. Miller.
First and foremost, as acting commissioner, I want to apologize on behalf of the Internal Revenue Service for the mistakes that we made and the poor service we provided. The affected organizations and the American public deserve better. Partisanship, or even the perception of partisanship, has no place at the IRS. It cannot even appear to be a consideration in determining the tax exemption of an organization. I do not believe that partisanship motivated the people who engaged in the practices described in the Treasury Inspector General's report.
Okay, well, good luck convincing us of that. And here is in cut 39, Chairman Dave Camp talks to Mr. Miller. No cut. Okay, all right, why don't we take a break and we'll come back and we'll see what we could do here on the Steve Malzberg Show. Sorry for the technical difficulties, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back. Don't go away.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
Attention hip implant patients. Are you in constant pain? Have you received a letter from your doctor about your implant? Have you had or need a revision surgery? Do you have high levels of metal, chromium, or cobalt in your blood? Over 90,000 hip implant devices have been recalled due to defects and failures resulting in revision or replacement surgery. If you have a recalled hip implant, you may be entitled to substantial financial compensation. Call 800-460-0920 to see if your implant is affected by the recalls. If you or a loved one has a defective or recalled hip implant, you may be entitled to substantial financial compensation. Call 800-460-0920. That's 800-460-0920. Protect your legal rights today. Call 800-460-0920.
This is an advertisement, not valid in all states. Paid non-attorney spokesperson. iLawsuit.com is an advertising group that represents lawyers advertising their services and is a free matching service for consumers. It is not a law firm or lawyer referral service.
According to the FBI Uniform Crime Report, there are over 5,000 robberies every day. Your home could be at risk of being burglarized. Don't put your loved ones and valuables in jeopardy. For just over a dollar per day, your home can be protected from break-ins, fire, and more. Get the latest home security technology from Protect Your Home, your ADT authorized dealer. Over 6 million households sleep better at night with ADT monitored home security. What's more, Protect Your Home is offering you their latest equipment, an $850 value, absolutely free for qualified customers. Protect your loved ones and home today. Call now for licenses and to find out more. The call is free, 1-800-949-8201. That's 1-800-949-8201. Again, 1-800-949-8201. $99 installation charge, 36-month monitoring agreement at $36.99 per month. Payment by credit card or electronic bank account charge. For new homeowner customers with satisfactory credit history only. Local permit fees may be required. Certain restrictions apply. Cannot be combined with any other offer.
Drug, alcohol, and gambling addiction can be devastating for you and your loved ones. Don't let the disease of addiction ruin everything you've worked so hard for. The Treatment Helpline has helped thousands of people just like you take control of their addictions and live healthier, cleaner, and happier lives. You are not alone. Now there's hope. The Treatment Helpline has helped people just like you overcome their addiction. If you or a loved one is suffering from a drug, alcohol, or gambling addiction, let us help you today. Call 1-800-813-9821. Our seasoned addiction treatment professionals can show you how to use your private health insurance to help cover the costs of this life-changing program. Call now and get a free confidential consultation. 1-800-813-9821. That's 1-800-813-9821. Help is only a phone call away. Call 1-800-813-9821. That's 1-800-813-9821.
What is Lignet? Lignet is knowledge. Lignet is power. Lignet is global. Top-level officials, U.S. intelligence officers, national security advisors, foreign operatives, all reporting directly to you. What is Lignet? Lignet is confidential. Lignet is sensitive. Lignet is security. What is Lignet? They're the ones taking the world's pulse. If you're not in the know, you're not on Lignet.com. You've been briefed.
In 2013, half of your friends, family, and neighbors may lose their jobs. all while you are robbed of 90% of your life savings, investments, and home's value. Controversial economist Robert Wiedemer, who was the only expert to predict the recession, has released a startling video with shocking evidence that the powers that be have tried to ban. But that hasn't stopped 50 million people from getting the truth. Watch it at Aftershock911.com. Aftershock911.com.
This is not your typical Scream Fest talk show.
No. No.
This is the next generation of talk radio. Here is Steve Malzberg.
This week, we learned that senior IRS officials knew about this activity almost 2 years ago in June of 2011, and IRS's leadership in Washington knew of it in May 2012, a year ago. Despite a two-year-long investigation by this committee, the IRS never told the American people or their representatives about this simple truth. In fact, we were repeatedly told no such targeting was happening. That isn't being misled. That's lying.
Indeed, that's Congressman Dave Camp, chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, here on the Steve Malzberg Show from the testimony earlier today. And I want you to also hear Congressman Ryan's exchange with Stephen Miller, the former acting head of the IRS, who was on the hot seat today. And here's how Cut 40 sounded.
You knew the terms Tea Party patriots were being used. You just acknowledged a minute ago that they were outrageous. And then when you were asked about this, after you were briefed about this, that was the answer you gave us? How can we not conclude that you misled this committee?
So that was a lot of questions, sir.
It's one. How can we conclude that you did not mislead this committee?
I did not mislead the committee. I stand by my answer then. I stand by my answer now. Harassment discussion that was part of that question implies political motivation. There is a discussion going on. There is no political motivation.
Let me ask it again.
May I answer the question, sir?
Let me just, I'm going to help you, give you some clarity here. Here's the question you were asked. What kind of letter or action is being taken place at this time that you are aware of?
So the discussion of the context of that, and again, we need to go back and look at the context. There was the listing. There was the treatment of the cases. My understanding of that question was the treatment of the cases because all of the letters, and he was talking, I think it was Mr. Marchant, was talking about the, I'm hearing that people are complaining about letters. My response was to that. We found out about those letters. We dealt with them. As has been explained, we gave more time. We went and talked to them about expanding the way they could answer it. And we dealt, I think, fairly and successfully with the donor list issue.
All right, this guy, Stephen Miller, he was responding. He testified before Congress before, and Paul Ryan was saying it's not only your duty to answer the questions, but to be totally forthcoming. And he was obviously not totally forthcoming the last time he testified. Let's welcome in Patrick Howley, Daily Caller, investigative reporter. Hello, Patrick. How are you, sir?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm okay. Before we get to the specific story that you broke yesterday and we were going to talk about today, I want you to hear a couple of cuts from today's hearings with me and comment on them. First of all, this is Congressman Tom Price, Cut 41. He was grilling Stephen Miller. And give a listen to this one.
Would you care to recharacterize what you just the unnecessary word? Is it illegal what they have done?
It is absolutely not illegal.
It's not illegal what the IRS has done.
So let me understand the question. What is your statement as to what is illegal?
Do you believe it is illegal for employees of the IRS to create lists to target individual groups and citizens in this country?
I think the Treasury Inspector General indicated that it might not be, but others will be able to tell that.
What do you believe?
I don't believe it is.
So he doesn't believe it's illegal to create, in effect, an enemies list, a target list, whatever you want to call the list, and go after those individuals or groups. Mind you, the question was groups or individuals, and he doesn't believe it's illegal. Wow.
I love how all these government agencies, you know, it's all, I don't believe it was illegal, or I don't think it was illegal. You know, the guidelines are so hazy in these government agencies, and it's all so politicized that these people really have no idea what the law is. They just go wherever the administration tells them to go.
Yeah, but I think that was very, very revealing, because at the same time he was claiming earlier in the testimony that there was no targeting. He took offense to the word targeting. But right. But even if you were targeting, he doesn't believe this. It's illegal. Now let's move on to something else. This speaks to the admission, and this is a blockbuster too, I believe, that this was all announced to the press. We learned about it last week through Lois Lerner, the head of the tax-exempt division of the IRS, when she said that the IRS had been applying extra scrutiny. This came out of the blue, it seemed, in response to a question during a panel at an American Bar Association conference last week. But as it turns out, as you'll hear now, this was not spontaneous. This was not only planned that she would reveal it, the whole question to Lerner was staged. Let's listen to cut 42.
Did you or any of your subordinates direct Lois Lerner to make the public statement at the panel discussion acknowledging the targeting of tax-exempt groups?
It was a prepared Q&A.
Do you know Ms. Celia Rohde, a member of IRS's Advisory Council on Tax-Exempt and Government Entities?
I do.
Was Ms. Rohde's question to Ms. Lerner about targeting conservative groups planned in advance?
I believe that we talked about that, yes.
So this whole question and answer was planned. They planned to drop this, to let this out last week, and that's one issue I'd like your opinion on, Patrick. And the other, the question that it begs is, why? Why, when Benghazi was heating up, when the pressure was on, why did they take that day and that time to sidetrack America? Granted, it might be a worse scandal, but do you feel there was any connection? So answer both those questions, please.
Well, I don't think this is a worse scandal, and as far as Obama is concerned, because it's more difficult to pin this back to Obama. Obviously, Lois Lerner could be a fall guy. The Stephen T. Miller is being made out to be a fall guy. It's very easy for Obama to go on in a press conference and say, we're going to hold these people responsible, there are going to be firings, there's going to be discipline being done. And so this is a distraction from Benghazi, which actually does indict Obama. And so I don't think it's a conspiracy theory at all, and we know now that it's not a conspiracy theory. I was saying this for days, that of course they manipulated the press, and of course this whole thing is a diversion from the real things that could come back to the Obama administration. And the press obviously is in Obama's pocket, and so you'll see things like Politico or National Journal running all these things like, well, every president uses the IRS in this way. Clinton used it, and Bush used it this way, and whether or not that's true, they're trying to play it all off as a big gaff.
Right. They repeatedly said Bush and Bush appointee, and every Democrat on the panel did that. I want to ask you though, Patrick, about the story that you broke, and again it relates to Lois Lerner. Her husband's law firm has ties, you say, to the Obama administration. So tell us about those connections.
Right. I mean, not just to the Obama administration, but also to the Obama campaign. Not that there's necessarily any difference between those two at this point, but they hosted an Obama campaign event. People who are interested in being involved with voter registration for the Obama campaign, they hosted that event in their own headquarters. One of the firm's partners was appointed ambassador to Singapore by Obama. This firm, it's called Sutherland. It's here. They have an office here in D.C. They're pretty prominent. They represented the Guantanamo detainees, and they're in the press a lot. And one of the partners became Obama's ambassador to Singapore. So this is a very politically connected law firm. And, all these bureaucrats, regardless of whether or not they classify themselves as apolitical, they all know somebody, or they're related to somebody, or they're friends with the right kinds of people in town. And here in Washington, we know this, but people in the country at large don't even know about these kinds of incestuous relationships.
Yeah, it is incestuous. And, of course, last week we learned that, of course, the brothers, respectively, of the heads of CBS and ABC News, each work for the Obama administration in positions that have bearing on Benghazi. But now here's another one. By the way, we're talking to Patrick Howley. He's the investigative reporter with the Daily Caller here on the Steve Malzberg Show. Again, we apologize for the technical difficulties at the beginning of the program. Sarah Hall Ingram, The IRS executive in charge of the tax-exempt division between 2010, when the targeting of the conservative groups started, got more than $100,000 in bonuses and in 2009, between 2009 and 2012, and she's now been promoted. She's now left that position. She is organizing. She's been promoted to head the IRS division in charge of Obamacare. This woman who oversaw possibly the targeting of groups and individuals, which the acting head now says, it's not illegal, is now taking over. She got a promotion for her work and is going to head up Obamacare for the IRS. You can't make this up, and yet I really don't hear the media talking about this.
No, I mean, it's ridiculous enough that the IRS has an entire division devoted to Obamacare. I mean, that's enough of an outrage. But the fact that this woman is now in charge of our health care, of our health and our lives, in terms of how these hospitals apply for tax-exempt status under the Accountable Care Organization program, it's just an absolute boondoggle. And it does nothing to restore the confidence of the American people in the Obama administration. But the media is not going to cover it. Of course they're not.
Well, I'll tell you, we're going to cover it, and I know you're going to cover it. And keep uncovering the incestuousness of it all, and keep uncovering the absurdities and the chutzpah of it all. And we'll keep talking about it here, Patrick. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Take care. All right, Patrick Howley, Daily Caller, here on the Steve Malzberg Show. When we come back, Senator Bob Corker will join us to talk about this, naturally. But also, the U.S. has made millions of dollars in secret cash payments to President Karzai of Afghanistan. What the heck is going on with that? We'll talk about it with the senator right here on the Steve Malzberg Show.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
Hi, I'm Joan London, and if you're worried about your parent or a loved one living alone like I was, and you want reliable senior care information, then call A Place for Mom, the nation's largest senior living referral service. You'll get free information on assisted living, Alzheimer's care, nursing homes, even important financial information.
They had obviously researched every place, not just given me names.
Really? Yeah.
They found me a place for what she could afford, and it was magnificent.
We're now very confident that she's safe, and they just helped every step of the way, and I can't thank them enough.
So if you're struggling to find reliable senior living information, call A Place for Mom. This is a free service, and you can trust them to help you.
If you're struggling to find reliable senior living information for your mom or dad, then call or go online to get the free help you need during this turbulent time. Call now, 800-908-1254, 800-908-1254.
Hi, this is Mike Reagan. Folks ask me, what would Ronald Reagan do if he were with us today? I believe the first thing he'd do is stop Obamacare. Already it's in effect with higher taxes, hidden fees, skyrocketing insurance rates, big Medicare cuts, and some insurance plans are hit with a 40% tax. Protect yourself by getting the Obamacare Survival Guide. It's already a number one New York Times bestseller. Newsmax says it's the best guide to the new law, giving you the strategies, tips, and loopholes you need to know. If you're insured on Medicare, a business owner, a medical professional, just about anyone, you need this book. Get the number one bestseller, the Obamacare Survival Guide, at bookstores everywhere. Or get our special $4.95 offer and save $15 off the cover price by going now to Obamacare911.com. Obamacare911.com. That's Obamacare911.com.
Meet Jim. Like many of us, Jim enjoys a busy life between work, family, and friends. His days zip along, and Jim has the energy to tackle almost anything. But lately, Jim's get up and go has literally taken on a new meaning. Jim's always put focus on a full night's sleep, but it seems like these days, he's up and down to go to the bathroom so many times he can barely wake up in the morning. His prostate concerns have him sad, tired, and worried. Activities that were once enjoyable now seem like a chore for Jim. His golf game is at the mercy of his bathroom schedule. Family outings are planned around it too. Jim even has difficulty going to the bathroom. He's tried so many prostate remedies, he can't keep them straight. And nothing ever seems to help. Then Jim found out about Prostate Revive, the all-natural dietary supplement specifically formulated for men, targeted towards improving and sustaining normal prostate function. Prostate Revive includes 15 super ingredients never combined before, including saw palmetto extract, beta-sitosterol, pomegranate fruit extract, selenium, and other high-quality nutrients. These targeted and all-natural ingredients promote healthy urinary flow and optimal prostate health. And the best part is, Prostate Revive was developed by a renowned medical doctor. Dr. David Brownstein personally formulated Prostate Revive with one goal in mind: to promote a healthy prostate gland. Thanks to Prostate Revive, Jim's got his life back. He gets a full night's sleep every night, and his friends and his wife can't believe he's the same guy. He has his old energy back, and no one has to wait for him. He doesn't even think about his prostate concerns anymore. Visit MedicSelect.com to take back your nights and improve your quality of life with Prostate Revive.
Are you tired of the insanity in talk radio? Well, there's a new voice during the afternoon. This is the Steve Malzberg Show.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. We are honored to be joined here on the Steve Malzberg Show by Senator Bob Corker from the great state of Tennessee, the ranking member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. Senator, welcome, sir. Hello. Welcome, Senator.
Hey, how are you, sir?
Good. Thank you for joining us. I really appreciate it. And I want to get to your letter to the president and what's going on with us delivering bags of money to Karzai in Afghanistan. But I would be remiss if I didn't try to get your views on what happened today. And I don't know if you saw it or not, but I could tell you a little bit about the hearing at the House Ways and Means Committee with the outgoing head of the IRS, Stephen Miller. First of all, he said that he did not believe that what happened, even if groups are targeted by the IRS, he believes it's not illegal. He also could not name any names of who initiated all this, who started it, who approved it. No names were mentioned. And he also revealed something very interesting, sir, that when we found the news out last week from Lois Lerner, the head of the tax-exempt division, it was at a American Bar Association conference, a Q&A, and he revealed that that Q&A, both of them, were pre-planned, purposely done, question purposely pre-written, answer purposely pre-written, so they intended for us to find out about it last week. So your take on all of that?
What did he say?
Well, he did. They didn't press him on. I mean, he just admitted that that was the case. I didn't. If they did press him on why it was released at that time, I mean, I have a theory. It's called Benghazi. Maybe it was a distraction. Yeah. But that's why I wanted to get your opinion on that.
Yeah, I've been in meetings all day and just stepped out to make this call. But look, this is chilling what the IRS has done, and I think this is probably going to play out over a long period of time before we get to the bottom of it, especially when your lead witness, if you will, the outgoing person, has as little knowledge to put forth as apparently he had today. I did read some clips to step out before this call was made and understand a little bit about what happened. But look, the IRS is an institution everybody in America understands. They understand the power that the IRS can have over individuals. They understand how oppressive the IRS can be if they choose to do so. And the fact that organizations like Tea Party groups and others have been targeted is really chilling. And I think that this is, again, going to take a long time to get to the bottom of and find out how high of a level within the administration knowledge of this was known, if you will. And I think with we have the health care bill coming on, it's going to be even more relevant to people when they realize that it's the IRS that is going to be the entity that's going to be overseeing what individuals throughout our country are doing relative to this new law.
Well, sir, I'm so glad you said that, because not relevant to the hearings today, but the fact of the matter is that Sarah Hall, the woman who was in charge of the nonprofit and overseeing that whole section from 2010 until fairly recently, she has been quote-unquote promoted. She is heading up the new division of the IRS that will be overseeing Obamacare.
Yeah, it's. I happen to believe that this episode is going to have a big effect on the implementation of health care. And what I mean by that is that people are going to realize that there are multiple issues that have to be addressed. But this is very chilling. I think obviously this is a wake-up call for all of those who see our large government and the ways that people can be coerced. And candidly, I think it's going to cause people's antenna to be up on numbers of other related issues. Anything, for instance, as we move to immigration reform, just being aware that there are a lot of judgments that take place within organizations. As we move through other pieces of legislation, when we ever deal with Fannie and Freddie, which hopefully will happen this year, a lot of judgments get made by organizations that have tremendous clout. So, look, this builds additional distrust in government, and candidly, I don't like to see that in America. I think a healthy distrust is something we should all have, but I think we should get to the bottom of this. It's going to take a while. It's going to affect other agencies of government. And that investigative and oversight process is what Congress is supposed to do, should do, and certainly there's going to be ample opportunities for that to be done over the next couple of years.
And one more, Senator, before we get to the important issue at hand here, and I know you did not see and hear, but I'm telling you, I could play you the cut if you so desired, that he did admit, again, that this was a pre-planned question. It was purposely revealed last week. Do you believe, if that's the case, as he stated, do you believe that, would you put it beyond this administration or someone in the administration to have created this as a diversion to take the focus off of Benghazi, because it was 2 days after the hearings?
If I were an administration official, as bad as Benghazi has been, and I think the new revelations about the State Department actually having been the entity that changed the talking points so that there would not be negativity towards them, I think that is a new development. Obviously, for me, a big issue has been there's been no accountability there. I mean, we have four employees that are still on government payrolls, that are on administrative leave, they're sitting in their homes. And I think that at some point soon, we need to either know, were they culpable or not? And by the way, I think there are people higher up in the State Department that also share some of the blame. But what I'm saying is this, Benghazi is an issue that certainly has captured the nation's attention. But when you start talking about an issue within the IRS, it's something that's far more relevant to every individual. Sometimes people, Benghazi's in Libya, and it's hard to understand what happened. Everybody in our country understands the IRS. And if this was to divert, I think it was a very bad move. And so because I think the entire public, Republicans, Democrats, and Independents, are hugely put off by this type of story. And so I don't think, candidly, from the standpoint of damage done to the administration, I think this is one, again, that more people in America will relate to even than Benghazi. And if it was an attempt to divert, and I'm not sure that I could go that
right.
far in my thinking. I doubt that, candidly. I don't think you divert with another terrible story that's even worse. So
fair enough.
So this one is even worse, I think, than Benghazi
right.
from the standpoint of how Americans are going to view the U.S. government.
We're talking to Senator Bob Corker from Tennessee, the ranking member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. And, sir, in that capacity, you recently wrote a letter to the President of the United States as part of your ongoing outrage and inquiry into why the CIA, according to Afghan President Hamid Karzai himself, why the CIA has been making delivering bags of cash to him for the past decade. Where are we? Has the White House responded to your inquiry?
And they did not respond to the first letter, and we gave them ample time. And so we wrote another letter, and we got a verbal response that, you know, this was not in our jurisdiction and therefore not really our business. Obviously, you know, it is in our jurisdiction. I'm a United States Senator. I'm ranking member on the Foreign Relations Committee. The State Department itself.
Whose business would it be, Senator?
I think they've since decided that that wasn't a very good response, and I think something will be coming soon. But think about it. We have this government in Afghanistan that has had corruption at the highest levels. We have been sending billions of dollars in aid to this country through the normal processes of government to government. And this is a democratically elected president, and we are still giving, quote, suitcases of cash to this president, according to him. I also understand there have been allegations we're actually doing that with other members of his family throughout the country. And so when you think about that, if Russia were doing that or if Iran were doing that, I have a feeling that we would think that's a pretty big deal. One of our missions is to make sure that we have the rule of law in these countries and that we do everything we can to overcome corruption. So this long into it with a democratically elected president, I just have no understanding how we feel that that is beneficial. And I want an answer, and I want a public answer, because this has come out in the public domain.
Yeah, and Karzai, between your first letter and your second letter, as you indicate in your second letter to the president, claims again publicly that the CIA, our CIA chief in Kabul, has assured him the payments will continue. Why would Karzai make this public knowledge anyway?
You know, I got to tell you, I know Karzai. I've met and I've been with him three times in Kabul and certainly here in the country, and he's an unusual guy, and you got to wonder why in the world he would make public comments to that end. But apparently, he's not ashamed of what is happening. Obviously, he's not ashamed that citizens throughout the country are aware that he may be receiving a lot of cash. And again, I just don't see how that jives, if you will, with the mission that our nation has with that country. I want to know why we're doing it. I understand when we go into conflict areas in the very beginning, there's no doubt we deal with cash. I mean, we have some of our military leaders that when we're building roads and other kind of things, we deal in that fashion. But with a government that's been in place for this long, has gone through two elections, this is not a proper approach, in my opinion. Maybe the administration feels that it is, but if they do, I want to know why. And with that, hey, I've got to step in.
Yeah, yes, meeting. Senator, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you for having me on. I'm sorry I hadn't listened to the IRS hearing this morning earlier.
No,
okay?
No, go ahead, sir. Thank you so much for your time.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Yes,
Senator Bob Corker, ladies and gentlemen, ranking a member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. The White House verbally responds to his inquest into why the CIA is dumping cash loads of money at Karzai's feet by saying it's not under the Senate Foreign Relations Committee's jurisdiction. Whose jurisdiction is it under? Maybe it's the IRS. Maybe we should get the IRS involved, huh? Find out why all that money's going to Karzai. Maybe they should audit him, or not give him. Maybe he's been granted some kind of charitable status or on tax exempt status. All right, folks. When we come back, there's a new study out that flies in the face of Nanny Bloomberg on salt. Turns out some salt's not so bad for you after all. And Angelina Jolie, of course, her double mastectomy. Now she says she's going to get her ovaries removed. We'll talk about that. It's the cover of Time magazine this week. A lot of women are interested. A lot of men are interested. We'll talk about it with our friend Dr. David Somati when we come back on the Steve Malzberg Show.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
A tragic fire, a break-in, a fall. Look, accidents and emergencies really do happen. The difference between life and death could be as simple as the push of a button. That's where Medical Guardian comes in. Are you afraid that something tragic may happen with no one around to help? What if you or your elderly loved one had a fall and lay for hours or even days before any help arrived? What if it was just too late? You don't have to live in fear that something terrible could happen. It's time you discovered Medical Guardian. Life-saving help at the push of a button. Get the peace of mind you need for yourself and your loved ones. Call 800-550-3470 right now. Be one of the first 100 callers and get your first month of Medical Guardian free. 800-550-3470. Call now and get your first month for free. The help you need is at your fingertips. Ensure your safety today with Medical Guardian. 800-550-3470. That's 800-550-3470.
Are you at least 62 years old like me? Could you use an extra $50,000, $100,000 or more to live a better life? Then please consider the benefits a reverse mortgage can provide to you. With a reverse mortgage, you can have your mortgage payments stopped altogether and get equity out of your home to live on. And you can use the money to help you live a better life. How nice would that be, not to have a mortgage payment? Qualifying for a reverse mortgage is simple, since there are no income, asset, employment, or credit requirements. However, you must be 62 years or older, own your home outright, or have a very low balance on the mortgage, and be prepared to live in it throughout the rest of the loan. Call now for more information.
800-831-1560. 800-831-1560. 800-831-1560. That's 800-831-1560.
Attention hip implant patients. Are you in constant pain? Have you received a letter from your doctor about your implant? Have you had or need a revision surgery? Do you have high levels of metal, chromium, or cobalt in your blood? Over 90,000 hip implant devices have been recalled due to defects and failures resulting in revision or replacement surgery. If you have a recalled hip implant, you may be entitled to substantial financial compensation. Call 800-460-1530 to see if your implant is affected by the recalls. If you or a loved one has a defective or recalled hip implant, you may be entitled to substantial financial compensation. Call 800-460-1530. That's 800-460-1530. Protect your legal rights today. Call 800-460-1530.
This is an advertisement, not valid in all states. Paid non-attorney spokesperson. iLawsuit.com is an advertising group that represents lawyers advertising their services and is a free matching service for consumers. It is not a law firm or lawyer referral service.
Do you owe the IRS? Do you have unfiled tax returns? Have you received a wage garnishment or bank levy? Maybe a lien has been filed against you. OMG Tax can help you with all your IRS tax problems. Don't wait another second. Take action now. Call my team at OMG Tax. Honest and professional, we don't make false promises. If you owe back taxes or if the IRS is garnishing your paycheck, you need help now. OMG Tax can help you get your life back to normal. If you're serious about handling your tax matter, call OMG Tax now and get the peace of mind you deserve. Don't let the IRS take your next paycheck. Stop waiting and call our team at OMG Tax. OMG Tax has a straightforward, no-nonsense approach and has helped many Americans resolve their IRS nightmare. Call OMG Tax now.
Call 1-800-255-6485. That's 1-800-255-6485. 800-255-6485.
3 a.m. and you're up again for the third time. It's not just affecting your sleep, it's interrupting your daily life. Frequent trips to the bathroom due to an aging prostate is a common concern, but you can now do something about it with Prostate Revive. Doctor-formulated Prostate Revive is an all-natural dietary supplement packed with 15 powerful ingredients focused on improving prostate health by targeting the two main sources of prostate concerns, rogue testosterone and inflammation. And now, in this limited-time radio offer, you can try Prostate Revive absolutely free. That's a free bottle, a 30-day supply of Prostate Revive, risk-free. Plus, if you call right now, you'll also receive our free report, A Doctor's Guide to a Healthy Prostate. Call now for details on getting your free bottle, plus our doctor's report. Call 1-800-659-REVIVE. That's 1-800-659-REVIVE. Don't be a victim of an aging prostate. Start getting the sleep you need and get your life back with Prostate Revive. Claim your risk-free bottle now at 1-800-659-REVIVE. Revive.
The new voice of talk radio is here. This is the Steve Malzberg Show. Call the show at 855-777-9660. Here is Steve.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Steve Malzberg Show. We are joined once again by our friend Dr. David Somati, Vice Chair, Department of Urology and Chief of Robotics and Minimally Invasive Surgery, Mount Sinai School of Medicine. Hello, Doc. How are you?
Hey, Steve, how are you? Happy Friday.
Yes, happy Friday. It's always happy Friday. We love happy Friday. Good to talk to you. All right, so much to get to. So let's start with Angelina Jolie and her double mastectomy. It's the cover of Time magazine this week, the whole thing. And women, I understand, calls to hospitals and doctors went up, you know, two, three, four, quadruple, whatever fold after she made the announcement in the New York Times. Explain to me, I mean, I know all about the gene. I know about the history that her mother died of cancer when she was young. So she had it removed to lessen her chances. But she kept her ovaries, which I now understand she's also going to have out. But if women take the breasts off and keep the ovaries, then they have a chance of getting ovarian cancer because removing the breast doesn't affect the ovarian cancer percentage, does it?
That's right. You're absolutely right. It doesn't. So, and also ovarian cancer is a much more aggressive cancer, as you know, than breast cancer. She's a very brave woman, actually. I never thought she would come out in public and talk about this, but she certainly has helped the field of breast cancer in the last week or so tremendously, and it brought a lot of attention to it. This gene that she has, which is the BRCA1, BRCA1 that she has, obviously increases the risk of having breast cancer by 87%. Now, the other thing that you mentioned, which is very accurate, is the family history that she has, and that also increases the risk. So I have no doubt that in the near future, she's going to remove those ovaries because there's a chance of having ovarian cancer. What also they have done is that they could have put in the breast implant at the same time, but she has chosen to put in tissue expanders and go back in sometime near future and get the cosmetic surgery to make sure that she would look the way she looks. So I think it has a nice ending, the fact that it was removed and there's no sign of any cancer left behind, and she's going to have a great recovery.
Now, when and if she has her ovaries removed, that will immediately send her into menopause at her young age. Will she be able to overcome that with hormone therapy?
Yes, and there are also risks that comes with hormones, so there's no question that there's going to be some physiological changes. But look, we want to have her around than having this cancer, which is a deadly one, ovarian cancer or even breast cancer when it metastasizes, yes. So there will be some uphill battles at a very young age of 37, but that's what it takes to be, you know, cancer-free. Unfortunately, she has the risk and the genes for it, and she's brave enough to go through it, and I salute her. And that tells you also one of the things that we've spoken about, that screening and getting your test and your genes and mammograms are extremely healthy. Had she not done all of this, she would have been in a horrible situation, which we'll come to the later on when it comes to PSA screening for men.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry to interrupt, but she has the wherewithal and the money. I mean, could any woman walk in and say, you know, my mother had breast cancer, my sister had breast cancer, I want this gene test done. How much does it cost, and does insurance cover it?
A lot of insurances may or may not cover it. I'm not sure about the exact price of it. I'll be happy to get back to you on that. But yes, if there's a family history that's really strong, they should be able to get this test done.
Okay, let's move on to, let's move on quickly to the PSA. New recommendations, again, just like they came out with these recommendations changing mammograms, they've been coming out with PSA recommendations that every man's going to get prostate cancer anyway. Why check for it? And now they're putting a limit on it even more. They don't want men to get PSA blood tests basically at all.
Yeah, this was a big shocker, and we came back from San Diego. In fact, the day before we got to the national meeting in San Diego, American Urologic Association shocked everybody that no PSA under the age of 55. And, of course, that increased a lot of anger among urologists, and that's going to send the wrong message to a lot of people out there. Without PSA, you're going to have a lot of men in their 40s and early 50s metastasize and have their cancers spread. Now, what they're saying is that checking the PSA through those ages can lead to some overdiagnosis and therefore overtreatment. And I think that's where we are having the problem. Overdiagnosis should not lead to overtreatment. And that's the reason why patients should know their PSAs and talk to the expert and find out when to do the surgery and when not to. With all the genetic tests that's coming also in the field of prostate cancer, major images, MRIs, will be able to distinguish and say, you know, this gentleman needs surgery quickly and this one we can sit tight.
Right.
But certainly giving the message of not getting tested, I think that's really bad message.
I just think it's also coincidental, doctor, that as we've talked about for years, that ever since they passed Obamacare, all these boards with all these recommendations, don't get tested, don't have a procedure, too costly, doesn't make sense. It just seems very tied in. But I want to hit you on salt before we run out of time.
No problem.
A new study showing, and maybe it's not as remarkable as it's being made out to be in the media somehow. I don't think anybody, and I'm not sticking up for Mayor Bloomberg, because he would tell you not to eat any salt, I'm sure. But I don't think anybody believes that you shouldn't have any salt, because then you'd have a deficiency. But does this say that moderate amount of salt is good and a necessity? Or does it say that, you know, you could even eat a little more salt and it's not so bad? What does it tell you?
Right now, what we have is that most Americans were getting about 3,400 milligrams of salt, which is almost double the amount that we actually need. And that's one of the reasons why the rate of high blood pressure is so high. Now, the American Heart Association recommends 1,500, which is half of that. I think there's a happy medium, and what this study is coming in and saying that if you're around 2,300, which is a teaspoon salt, you should be fine, and you don't really have to go all the way down to 1,500. I happen to agree that, you know, a certain amount of salt is absolutely important for your physiology, for your cells. So you don't have to take 3,400, and you don't need 1,500. A happy medium, somewhere around 2,000, is enough. Now, where do we get most of that salt? With all the diet that we have, from bread to other things that we eat, we get that amount. So the big message to a lot of people out there is, you don't add any more salt to your food. You're getting enough, and if you start adding more, that's when you're going to get to high numbers, and that's when we're going to see a lot of high blood pressure.
Right, so, and if you eat out, you don't even know how much salt you're getting in the food. It's probably much, much more than if you cook at home, fresh fruit, fresh vegetables, whatever, because they want it to be tasty in the restaurant. So, right, so don't add salt to anything, basically, and you'll probably be okay.
That's what I do, because you're already getting enough in everything, in your pasta, in your bread, in all the things that we have. We're getting enough. If you are one of those guys that has a salt shaker and is adding more, yeah, you're going to get into trouble.
Right, absolutely. And soup. Watch out for canned soup, because it's through the roof. All right, doctor, have a great weekend, my friend. Very informative. Thank you.
Great talking to you. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Dr. David Somati, ladies and gentlemen. When we come back, president of the South Texas Political Alliance and former president of the San Antonio Tea Party, his Hispanic Tea Party group was gone after by the IRS. We'll talk to him and Noel Shepard, Malzberg's Media Madness. Don't go away.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
If you owe the IRS back taxes and they're making your life miserable, get ready for a special free offer. Expert tax advisors can help you protect your home from liens, stop wage garnishment, and give you immediate collection relief. In fact, we guarantee to contact the IRS within 30 minutes of you becoming a client to start the tax relief process. Don't try to take on the most powerful organization in the United States by yourself. Call for free tax relief information and a free consultation on how we can help you. There is no cost or obligation to discover the programs that are available to stop your IRS problems from getting worse. Call our toll-free helpline now, 800-390-6910. That's 800-390-6910. The IRS will not go away. The pressure you feel now will only grow. Get the help you deserve. Call for a free no-obligation consultation now. Tax relief is just a phone call away. Call expert tax advisors at 800-390-6910. That's 800-390-6910.
Don't complain about your cable bill going up and up and up. Do something about it. Grab a pencil and jot down this special number. 1-855-625-MY-TV. The more cable TV rates go up, the better digital satellite TV looks. So cancel the cable and get more of your favorite channels in 100% digital quality for less money. Call 1-855-625-MY-TV. Right now to sign up for packages starting as low as $19.99, and there's no equipment to buy. You get free HD TV upgrade, a free DVR upgrade, and free professional professional installation. You control what you watch, when you watch it. Record your favorite shows. Pause and rewind live TV. Even skip the commercials. Watch local channels too. At just $19.99, what are you waiting for? Pull out your major credit or debit card. Call 1-855-625-MYTV. 1-855-625-MYTV. Cancel the cable. Cut costs and get more. 1-855-625-MYTV. 1-855-625-MYTV.
Hello and welcome to your Newsmax Now update. I'm John Bachman. The man at the center of the IRS scandal faces tough questions from Congress today. Stephen Miller was fired this week for his role in the targeted scrutiny and auditing of conservative groups by the IRS. Miller was asked today why he did not come clean when certain members of Congress started poking around and looking into the unusually long wait times for Tea Party and other conservative groups to get their tax-exempt status. Miller claims that all political applicants receive scrutiny, and the unit overseeing these applications was undermanned.
Mr. Chairman, I did not mislead Congress nor the American people. I answered the questions as they were asked.
Meanwhile, the president has replaced Miller with White House budget official Danny Warfel. He'll hold the post until the end of September. And yet another member of the military's sexual harassment program is now in trouble. An Army Lieutenant Colonel, whose name was not released, headed up the Sex Assault Prevention Unit at Fort Campbell, Kentucky, but he was arrested after a domestic dispute with his wife. He has now been relieved of his duties. And on Thursday, President Obama met with top Pentagon leaders looking for a solution. After that, the chief of the Army, issued a statement admitting that it is failing to combat sexual assault. There are high-profile cases like Lieutenant Colonel Jeffrey Kaczynski, the former head of the Sexual Assault Prevention Unit in the Air Force. He's now charged with groping a woman, and an Army sergeant at Fort Hood. He was also in charge of his unit's sexual assault prevention, but now he's under investigation for sexual assault and prostitution. And meteorologists say a total of 16 tornadoes slammed into North Texas Wednesday night, leaving six people dead in their wake. Homes of all shapes and sizes could not withstand winds of up to 200 miles per hour from a Wednesday tornado that hit in North Texas. It was an EF4, the second most powerful type. Meanwhile, 25 miles away, residents were sifting through debris and counting their blessings after a tornado struck there, but that tornado did not take any lives.
I mean, all of our children are safe. We're safe. Our house is demolished, our cars are, but the most important thing's right here. I mean, honestly.
And coming up next on your Newsmax Now update, it's the world's largest flawless diamond. So how much was someone willing to pay to take it home? And violent protests in Turkey, just as the nation's prime minister meets with President Obama. See what sparked this outrage. And a Newsmax exclusive with Senator Marco Rubio, what the IRS scandal could mean for the Senate's immigration bill. That's next.
This is a referral service. Calls will be routed to an independent referral insurance agency.
Do you know the number one cause of bankruptcy? No, it's not losing your job or running up credit card debt. It's not even divorce. It's medical costs. If you and your family don't have health insurance, just one serious illness or accident could be financially devastating. But now there's good news, really good news. A health insurance hotline has been established to provide health insurance for all Americans, even uninsured Americans with pre-existing conditions. Now anyone can get health insurance even if you have a pre-existing medical condition. I repeat, now anyone can get health insurance coverage. Call now for a free no-obligation quote on affordable health plans available to you. Again, this is a free hotline for anyone, even if you have pre-existing conditions. Protect you and your family from sudden unexpected medical costs. Call the free health insurance hotline right now at 1-800-910-3470. That's 1-800-910-3470. Call 1-800-910-3470.
Have you ever wondered how you could make a difference in someone's life? What if you could help hundreds or even thousands of children? Students in the U.S. rank 32nd in world math skills. It's time for our children to catch up. Become an owner of one of the world's fastest growing franchises, Mathnasium. Mathnasium is the leading math-only learning center in the U.S. Imagine helping hundreds, even thousands of students in your community improve in school and raise their self-esteem. Call us at 800-676-5216. 800-676-5216.
Last chance now at 23 million.
And welcome back. This is the world's largest flawless diamond, and it was just sold at auction this week. The pear-shaped stone is about the size of a golf ball and weighs just over 100 carats. The price tag? $26.7 million. It was purchased by the Harry Winston Jewelry Group. And in Turkey, protesters clashed with police over two bombing attacks on the border with Syria that killed dozens of people. The protesters say the Turkish government and other countries around the world are not doing enough to deal with the massive amount of Syrian refugees crossing the border. Some believe the refugees include jihadists and fighters loyal to the Assad regime, and that's why they may have been targeted by these bombings. Four people, all Turks, have been arrested for the attacks. This all comes as the Turkish prime minister just wrapped up a visit at the White House. And with four congressional committees looking into the IRS scandal, we should find out what the White House knew and when. And during a recent Newsmax exclusive interview, Senator Marco Rubio says that no matter what the White House knew or didn't know, this and other scandals are symptoms of the president's faulty leadership.
The fundamental problem, and I called for that, by the way, earlier in the week, the fundamental problem here is this culture of intimidation. It's basically this. You have a president, an administration, and a political apparatus around him who has decided that the way to win the political battles of the day is to destroy your political opponents, to basically impugn their motives, to talk bad about them, to convince people that they're bad people.
And to see the rest of this interview and more of our exclusive content, stay with Newsmax.com. This has been your Newsmax Now update for May the 17th. I'm John Bachman. Now here's the Steve Malzberg Show in New York.
Microphones hot. Satellite link established. Studio lights illuminated. Cameras rolling. Audio and video encoders firing ones and zeros. Internet stream. Streaming. The most technology advanced radio show is on the air. Here's the captain of this enterprise, Steve Malzberg.
Would you care to recharacterize the unnecessary word? Is it illegal what they have done?
It is absolutely not illegal.
It's not illegal what the IRS has done.
So let me understand the question. What is your statement as to what is illegal?
Do you believe it is illegal for employees of the IRS to create lists to target individual groups and citizens in this country?
I think the Treasury Inspector General indicated that it might not be, but others will be able to tell that.
What do you believe?
I don't believe it is.
All right, why doesn't this guy go, make a phone call to Fidel or the successor to Hugo in Venezuela, or give Vladimir a call, because he would fit right in there. Welcome back to the Steve Malzberg Show, hour number two. What Congressman Price, who joins us on Monday, by the way, what Congressman Price asked Stephen Miller, the former acting head of the IRS, was, do you believe it's illegal for the IRS to target groups or individuals? Now, all throughout the hearing, Stephen Miller said, I take exception to the word targeting because we didn't target anybody. But in that question, he was asked, targeting groups and individual citizens in this country. And he doesn't believe that it's illegal. So an enemies list for the IRS to target, he doesn't think it's illegal. Wow. Wow. I'll give you Fidel's number if I could find it. Actually, get it from Jay-Z and his wife, whatever their name is. Joining us right now, ladies and gentlemen, is George Rodriguez, president of the South Texas Political Alliance, former president of the San Antonio Tea Party. Hey, George, how are you, sir?
Real good, thank you. How are you doing?
Do you believe what I just played and what went on today?
No, when I heard it this morning, I was in shock. I would like for him to say that to the NAACP or to Planned Parenthood or some other group like that and say, you know, it's all right for us to target you guys. I'd like to see what Nancy Pelosi would have to say about that one.
Yeah, well,
it was incredible.
Yeah, it was so incredible. I can't even tell you. He also said during the course of the hearings that he was asked, you know, who ordered these, who signed off on these, who, how did this happen? He had no names. No names whatsoever. Yeah. Took exception to the word targeting. You know, when I was watching, this was an arrogant man, in my opinion, who he apologized. But basically, he said, you know, we're overworked and we were just trying to save time somehow. He wanted more funding. Just incredible stuff.
Yeah, I mean, it was it sounded more like it was a pitch for growing the government than it was for getting after them for what they did.
Yeah, let's play 38 for you. Could we play 38? Then we'll get to your group and what you went through. Here's cut 38.
I think that what happened here was that foolish mistakes were made by people trying to be more efficient in their workload selection. The listing described in the report, while intolerable, was a mistake and not an act of partisanship. The agency is moving forward. It has learned its lesson. We've previously worked to correct issues in the processing of the cases described in the report, and we've implemented changes to make sure that this type of thing never happens again. Now that TIGDA has completed its fact-finding and issued its report, management will take appropriate action with respect to those responsible.
You believe any? Well, first of all, he's out. I mean, he's done. But do you believe any of that?
Of course not. Particularly when he uses the phrase "mistakes were done." I'm going to do that on my next 1040 form when I send it in. You know, mistakes were made, and let's see how far I can get with it. That's incredible.
It is, and you know what the deal is here. The woman who was in charge of that division, not only did she get several tens of thousands of dollars in bonuses over the last few years, she is now the woman, I believe her name is Sarah Hall, who is now going to head up the IRS role in Obamacare.
There you go. And that makes me feel very, very comfortable that Obamacare is going to be digging into our pockets now. It makes me feel a whole lot more comfortable.
All right, well, George, let's talk about what specifically you're here to talk about, and that is that the IRS workers tried to intimidate you and other members with excessive paperwork and questioning. Talk about what your group went through, and am I mistaken? Would you call your group as the San Antonio Tea Party group basically a Hispanic Tea Party group?
Well, we're at least 40%. We're probably larger than that on that aspect.
Okay.
I know that the South Texas Alliance has at least 50% membership of Hispanics. So, I mean, it is definitely one of those situations where our organization is not as they stereotype it as an old white man type organization.
Forbid any organization should be a white man organization.
Oh yeah, right, exactly. Well, you know, we don't want to be racist.
Right,
course,
right.
You know? But the situation was that, you know, shortly after the Tea Party movement began, we made an application, of course, to try to get nonprofit status. And about 3 months, we've got this one letter asking us for further information, which we thought was okay. But then we started getting a series of letters. We got one letter in particular that had about 20 questions to it. And within that, within those questions were a lot of sub-questions, were a lot of other questions within each one of those questions. And, you know, those are the ones that are now being talked about that were famously asking you for who was attending your meetings, what were your meetings all about, give us a list of your donors. How much money are they giving you, et cetera, et cetera. You know, phone numbers and et cetera, et cetera. I mean, it was very, very intrusive. Now, let me preface this by saying that I have been involved in politics for over 35 years. I worked in the Reagan administration, and I worked in the first Bush administrations. I've been around in organizing groups, et cetera. So I knew. You know, whenever you're asking for whenever you're applying for nonprofit status, I know the process, and this was far, far out of the norm. This was way beyond. The questions that were being asked were just not your normal questions for anybody applying for a nonprofit status.
Well, how did you handle how did your organization handle it and deal with it?
Well, our board, and again, our board was composed of mostly brand new people who were new to the political process, folks. Mom and pop type folks who were just getting themselves involved. Well, they got panicked. A lot of the folks began to get absolutely panicked because, I mean, you just don't deal with the IRS. Everybody had a respect for this agency, and here this agency is playing politics with you. We knew it, and people weren't sure about what why they were asking all these things, and they started panicking. It really affected our organization. It caused a lot of division. It caused a lot of anxiety for folks within the movement at that point, who were just flat scared. I mean, I can't describe it in any other way.
Did it cause you to lose membership?
Oh yeah, it did. It caused us the loss of I'd say at least 50% of our membership.
You said 50%?
Yeah.
Wow.
Exactly.
Wow.
Because and they dropped out because both they were scared of what was being asked if they were in leadership position, but also because of the leaders were also scared of taking any kind of action. Our organization was kind of frozen in time for a while in activity. I mean, we weren't doing anything. We weren't challenging local politics. We weren't taking public stands. It was a bad time. It was an absolutely bad time.
But go ahead.
Yeah, and that's what really angers me, is that if the intended effect was to freeze us out of the democratic process, that's what happened. That's exactly what happened.
And do you plan on suing? So many Tea Party groups are involved in either individual or class action type of, or should I say multi-group suits? I don't know if it's class action. Uh-huh. Have you talked to anybody, any lawyers or anything along those lines?
Well, I have certainly encouraged. I am no longer on but I certainly am encouraging them to take legal action, because I will tell you that a simple apology by the president and a resignation, particularly by this character, by this Miller character, who has shown his colors today, it's not sufficient. What we need. We need somebody to go to jail. We need several people to go to jail.
Now you're starting to sound like John Boehner and other Republicans. How dare you?
Oh, can you imagine?
How dare you? Oh my God! I got to tell you. You know, it is incredible. We also, let me get your opinion on this, George. We're talking to George Rodriguez. We also found out today from Stephen Miller that when the revelation was made by Lois Lerner, the head of the tax exempt division, last week, it was at an American Bar Association conference Q&A, and we found out today that the question was planned. And the answer was planned. They wanted this information to come out at that forum last week, and they did it on purpose. Do you have any guess as to why they might have done that?
Oh gosh, I can't. This doggone administration has been so doggone political. There is nothing that they do that is not pre-planned and that is not with some kind of shady activity in mind, and I hate to sound like a conspiracy theorist, but after 5 years of this administration, I can't help but feel that every time they do something, it's like a volleyball game. They're setting it up for you to do something.
But
else.
Just remember, the president knows nothing.
Oh gosh, yes.
Nothing. He and Eric Holder, they both know nothing. This administration, the Justice Department, it's all being run by other people. Holder and Obama, apparently, they have lunch together, breakfast together, and dinner together, and they don't know anything.
Gosh,
unbelievable.
If this was somebody else, if this was a Republican president, oh my gosh, Chris Matthews would be having a
yeah. Well, Chris Matthews, he's developed his own definition of racism, which he originally but he reiterated it again yesterday. He brought it up in response to something Rush said, and then he reiterated it again yesterday, where paraphrasing, but racism is keeping whites supremacist. In other words, keeping the white race the supreme race. That's what racism means. So I guess he's going to rewrite the dictionary definition for all the dictionaries in the world. Hey, George, a pleasure talking to you, sir.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for talking to me.
You're welcome. George Rodriguez, ladies and gentlemen, president of the South Texas Political Alliance, former president of the San Antonio Tea Party. That's it. I got to tell you, it's insane. What I heard today was an arrogant man who did nothing wrong, who knows not who did anything wrong. And by the way, even if they did what they're accused of doing, which they didn't do, it's not against the law in his opinion. So, what's the ruckus about? And by the way, the IRS needs more funding because they did this to really become more efficient. They did this to save time because they're so overwhelmed. They need more money. So if we just give the IRS some more money, everything would be hunky-dory. Wow. Arrogance. My name is Steve Miller. Stephen Miller. I don't want to have that intertwined with Steve Miller, the singer. Anyway, all right, when we come back, well, at the bottom of the hour, we're going to be joined by Noel Shepard, Malzberg's Media Madness. And then later in the hour, Candace Cameron Bure. Remember the TV show Full House? Well, she was a star of Full House. She is an outspoken Christian woman in Hollywood, and we'll talk to her later in the hour. So don't go away on the Steve Malzberg Show.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
Guys, you've heard about Ageless Male, the natural supplement that helps boost testosterone levels within normal, healthy ranges. But now, the best testosterone product is even better. New and improved Ageless Male can help you feel more like you used to in your active life and in your romantic life. Because our upgraded formula has been clinically shown to increase your drive, desire, and performance. That's right, guys. Ageless Male has been clinically shown to boost performance. Cancel your plans this weekend. You're staying in. If you're ready to recapture the drive from your youth, now is the time to try Ageless Male because it's available risk-free. But you must call now. Just call 1-800-460-9790. Be the guy you used to be. Just call 1-800-460-9790. 1-800-460-9790. 1-800-460-9790.
If you or someone you love is struggling with addiction to alcohol or drugs, then you must listen to this message because there is hope. No matter what addiction you or your loved one is coping with, you are just one phone call away from real help. Recovery Hotline makes the healing process simple and affordable by matching people to fully certified and experienced inpatient facilities that are right for their personal situations. Call 800-668-1286 now. Don't wait another day. Money does not have to be an issue. Most insurance is accepted. Just call 800-668-1286. 1286 today. Recovery Hotline's mission is to help you or someone you love begin the healing process and get back a healthy and sober life. And we can even help with family interventions and travel arrangements. One phone call is all it takes to get back the life you or your loved one deserves. The call is free. The help is real. Call 800-668-1286. That's 800-668-1286. 800-668-1286. Again, 800-668-1286.
What is Lignet? Lignet is knowledge. Lignet is power. Lignet is global. Top-level officials, U.S. intelligence officers, national security advisors, foreign operatives, all reporting directly to you. What is Lignet? Lignet is confidential. Lignet is sensitive. Lignet is security. What is Lignet? They're the ones taking the world's pulse. If you're not in the know, you're not on Lignet.com. You've been briefed.
Hi, this is Dick Morris. Obamacare is taking full effect this year with over 15,000 pages of regulations. You need to know how this law affects you. That's why you should get your copy of Obamacare Survival Guide. It's easy to read and the best guide to the new law. Even if you're currently insured or a senior on Medicare or a business owner, a medical profession, or really any citizen, you need the Obamacare Survival Guide. In it, you'll find about hidden taxes, fees, and fines, including a 40% tax on some health plans. I warned you about Obamacare, its rationing, Medicare cuts, and will trigger doctor shortages. Now the Obamacare Survival Guide gives you the simple steps to protect your family. So get the Obamacare Survival Guide at bookstores everywhere. It's already a number one Amazon bestseller. Or get our special $4.95 offer and save $15 today by going to Obamacare911.com. Obamacare911.com. That's Obamacare911.com.
Obamacare. More than a trillion in new costs. Hidden taxes, fees, big Medicare cuts, doctor shortages. How can we survive?
To know Obamacare is to survive Obamacare. The Obamacare Survival Guide tells you everything you need to know to protect yourself, your family, your business. The Obamacare Survival Guide. At bookstores everywhere. Special internet-only offer right now at Obamacare911.com.
Are you tired of the inanity? I mean,
Insanity in talk radio? Well, there's a new voice during the afternoon. This is the Steve Malzberg Show.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. In just a few minutes, we will be joined by our buddy Noel Shepard, Malzberg's Media Madness, and there is a heck of a lot to talk about, certainly. There's a story from the Daily Caller. The Department of Homeland Security, this is amazing. They've obtained a checklist entitled Countering Violent Extremism, Do's and Don'ts, from the Department of Homeland Security's Office of Civil Rights and Civil Liberties. And it notifies local and national law enforcement officials that it's Obama administration policy to consider specifically Islamic criticism of the American system of government as legitimate. That's right. The memo protects the free speech rights of pro-Sharia Muslim supremacists, according to the Daily Caller. The policy is in stark contrast to the DHA Office of Intelligence and Analysis 2009 memo, Right-Wing Extremism, Current Economic and Political Climate Fueling Resurgence and Radicalization and Recruitment, which warned of the dangers, if you recall, posed by pro-life advocates, critics of same-sex marriage, and groups concerned with abiding by the U.S. Constitution, among others. The advice of the do's and don'ts list is far more conciliatory. Don't use training that equates radical thought, religious expression, freedom to protest, or other constitutionally protected activity, including disliking the U.S. government, without being violent, the manual's authors write in a section on being sensitive to constitutional values. But this is for the group specific to Muslims, according to the story here in the Daily Caller. It's quite different than what it said back in 2009. So I found this fascinating. And yesterday we told you about this, but I don't think it could be repeated enough. The National Labor Relations Board, which, you know, has been for a long time accused of making union-friendly decisions, was dealt another blow yesterday. But more importantly, the Obama administration was dealt another blow yesterday, and specifically the president himself. Because the president made those so-called recess appointments to the NLRB, and now a second court has determined that what the president did was unconstitutional. Yet I did not hear this reported on any of the news shows last night that I watched. I haven't seen it talked about on the cable shows. I'm not talking about Fox. I monitor the liberal ones, okay? So I'm sure it was addressed on Fox. So the 2-1 decision from the Philadelphia court, judges said Obama has no constitutional authority to install attorney Craig Becker to the labor board in 2010 while the Senate adjourned for 2 weeks. It's the second ruling on these so-called recess appointments. The Senate was not in recess. And Obama said, what do I care? I'm Barack Obama. Now two courts have said, unconstitutional, Mr. President. You think he cares? I don't think he cares one little tiny bit, because the Constitution is his impediment. On the Steve Malzberg Show.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
Tired of calls, levies, and liens from the IRS, or hiring others who don't get the job done? Call Wall & Associates and you'll never talk to the IRS again. The IRS has a program to eliminate tax debt, and Wall & Associates professionals are trained to maximize its benefits for you. You always speak with a live person with real support and real knowledge. We've helped thousands of taxpayers like you settle their tax debt with the IRS for a fraction of what they owe. We solve tax problems. Call Wall & Associates now. 800-574-6029. We have the professionals who know how to solve tax problems. If you owe money to the IRS, your tax problems are not going away by themselves, and the passage of time will only make matters worse. Act now, before it's too late. Call Wall & Associates right now to speak to a professional tax relief agent. Call 800-574-6029. That's 800-574-6029. Again, 800-574-6029.
online.
If you need to lose weight and would like to get paid for it, that's right, I said get paid to lose weight. Just listen to the following announcement. The makers of GCE Green Coffee Bean Weight Loss are looking for real testimonials from real people and will pay you per pound to meet or exceed your weight loss goal. Until now, the secrets of green coffee's fat-burning power has been limited. But thanks to Dr. Oz, the secret is out. And now, this authentic green coffee bean fat burner is available in easy-to-take tablets. There are no expensive meals to buy or strenuous workouts. Simply take one tablet before each meal and record your progress. Only the first 200 callers are guaranteed to be accepted into the program. So if you're serious about losing extra weight and want to earn extra cash for fitting into your skinny jeans again, call 800-383-9230 now. Call 800-383-9230. 800-383-9230. Space is limited, so hurry and secure your spot today. 800-383-9230. Some conditions apply. 800-383-9230. 800-383-9230.
Here's today's silver shortage update from Lear Capital.
Reports keep coming, the shortage is growing. Twice already this year, the U.S. Mint has run out. Last time this happened, the silver price jumped 40%. It's time to take advantage with this special offer from Lear Capital.
For a limited time, buy 20 new silver polar bear coins and get one free. The only 1.5 ounce coin on the market. It's minted with the finest silver, carries a government guarantee, and is eligible for IRAs. The Silver Polar Bear is available exclusively from Lear Capital. But don't wait. Silver supplies are shrinking and availability is not guaranteed. This offer is limited to a minimum purchase of $5,000. Call right now. 800-634-0482. 800-634-0482. Call Lear Capital now. 800-634-0482.
Hi, this is Mike Reagan. Folks ask me, what would Ronald Reagan do if he were with us today? I believe the first thing he'd do is stop Obamacare. Already it's in effect with higher taxes, hidden fees, skyrocketing insurance rates, big Medicare cuts, and some insurance plans are hit with a 40% tax. Protect yourself by getting the Obamacare Survival Guide. It's already a number one New York Times bestseller. Newsmax says it's the best guide to the new law, giving you the strategies, tips, and loopholes you need to know. If you're insured on Medicare, a business owner, a medical professional, just about anyone, you need this book. Get the number one bestseller, The Obamacare Survival Guide, at bookstores everywhere. Or get our special $4.95 offer and save $15 off the cover price.
Scroll down now to claim your copy of Obamacare Survival Guide for the special internet offer of only $4.95.
Are you ready?
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Broadcasting live from the Newsmax studios, this is the Steve Malzberg Show. Be a part of the action by calling 855-777-9660. That's 855-777-9660. Or email Steve at malzbergshow@newsmax.com. Here is Steve Malzberg.
As if you didn't know, welcome back to the Steve Malzberg Show. It is Friday. It's midway through the show. And that means it's time for our buddy, the associate editor of newsbusters.org, the great Noel Shepard. Hello, Noel.
Hello, Steve.
How are you?
All right. How are you, sir?
Good. We're a week removed from the lesbian story by David Letterman. I mean, I can't believe it's a week.
By the way, you know, we can talk about it again if you'd
no,
like.
No, that's okay. That's okay. But I just thought I'd bring it up so it would rekindle whatever it would rekindle. Anyway, yeah. All right. Let's get serious here and let's talk about you know, the week that has been, the scandals, one after the other. And, you know, one of the stories you wrote quotes Mitch McConnell, the minority leader of the Senate, basically saying, you know, if this were a Republican administration with the IRS scandal and the AP, Justice Department AP records being seized. And by the way, Holder also said he's done this before and he just doesn't even know how many times. So maybe your records, maybe my records have also been pulled by the government. If this were a Republican administration, I mean, they'd be starting impeachment proceedings at the behest of the media.
Yeah, I think what's interesting, we have to give the media some credit here. I mean, there actually have been folks like, for example, even Chris Matthews, John Stewart has been totally excoriating the president show after show this week for these scandals. So what I think has been interesting here is we have seen some media criticism of Obama from unlikely sources, again, including Chris Matthews. Rachel Maddow last night actually went after Obama for the AP scandal. So I think that what's occurring here is we've kind of had that last straw. I mean, the media now for, let's call it 6 years since Obama first threw his name into the ring in February of 2007, have been carrying his water. So that's, you know, a good six and a quarter years. They've been carrying his water, and they've been defending him in every turn. And I think that what's occurred here is for some of them, I think that the Maghazi story, the fact that they felt that they were being lied to, and then you throw in this IRS thing, and they know. I mean, people on both sides of the aisle and conservative and liberal media know. This IRS story, it upsets people across the country. This is not a liberal versus conservative anger. This is liberals and conservatives angry about the thought of an administration using the IRS to intimidate people. So I think that what we've got here is we've just gotten to the point where they're not necessarily willing to defend anymore, but they're not all on the attack. And what as much as they should be. And I think that what McConnell was telling the media, he said that to a group of reporters at a Senate leadership after a Senate leadership luncheon. I think his point was, you know, when you go back and you start reporting, particularly on the IRS, how would your report look if this was a Republican president?
Right.
And I think that even with the people that are, let's say, doing some fairer reporting, I'm not sure that the anger is at the level that it should be. I think it's going to depend upon what more comes out. I mean, if this really does, I mean, we just found out that, you know, the IRS, the IG that was on Capitol Hill in a congressional testimony just said that he first reported this last June. Wow. So now we know that the administration was aware of this going back to 5 months before Election Day and decided not to say anything for almost another year. Wow, that's scary stuff.
Well, yeah, I mean, the president yesterday, basically skidded around a question of when he knew, and he said, I was not aware of the IG report until you all heard about it in the news. But he did not, and the question asked to him was, when did you know about, you know, what was going on with the IRS? Now, we've heard about these accusations for years. It seems inconceivable that he had no idea, but, you know, he didn't answer that yesterday, and that's going to be very, very telling if he ever does have to answer that. I do want you to hear along the lines of what you were saying. This will be cut 36, Will. This is Willie Geist and I guess it's Joe Scarborough actually talking about tyranny with regard to the scandal. And here's cut 36.
One other point to make, there's been many overblown claims of tyranny and abuse of power from the government over the last few years.
Right.
We've heard those when it comes to we're coming for your guns,
oh, sure.
That kind of thing.
Sure.
This is tyranny.
This is.
If this is the government, a nonpartisan agency coming after specific groups, this time it's real. That's tyranny.
I'll just be honest with you. I can't imagine much, Mark Halperin, worse than this.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty strong. They did some of them backtracked on that show, I think, this morning or after that. But this was strong language.
It was strong language, especially because what they were doing here to a certain extent was vindicating the Tea Party folks and vindicating Second Amendment folks who have been talking. I mean, not completely vindicating, but bringing them up anyway or referring to them. People have been saying for 3 months, 4 months, 5 months now since Sandy Hook, that stronger gun laws, all they do is give the government greater authority and greater control to potentially commit acts of tyranny. And for Willie Geist, not as shocking that Scarborough would agree with him, but for Willie Geist to come out and say, you know, this, and he said it twice, this is tyranny. He's 100% right. This is tyranny, and it's very scary. And again, this is when you've got people on MSNBC talking this way, even Joe Scarborough and Willie Geist, the administration is in a lot of trouble on this one. And,
yeah.
And the media, I think they smell blood in the water at this point. And, you know, something that we need to address here, it's 2013. So there is no election this year. We're not in a campaign mode yet.
Right.
So the media can actually be far more aggressive this year on Obama and the administration and Democrats than conceivably they've been, well, maybe since 2011.
Right.
Excuse me, 2011. Maybe since 2007.
Yeah, no,
it's been a long time since the media have been in a position where they can actually go after Democrats and go after a Democrat president without there being any real immediate political electoral consequence. So what we might be seeing here is they want to get as much out now, and the media want to actually behave as much like, I mean, for the first time again since conceivably 2006 maybe, or 2007, or early 2007, they want to look conceivably as fair and balanced as they've been in a long time,
yeah.
Because they know once January rolls around and we start talking about midterm elections, they're not going to be able to do this.
Right. We're talking to Noel Shepard of newsbusters.org here on the Steve Malzberg Show. And, yeah, of course, some people like Chuck Todd have already started saying that if the Republicans overreach, they'll be punished the way they were after 1998.
No, and that's a good point. And that's a good point, Steve, because now where we are, because it is Friday, and happy Friday, by the way. Yeah. We'll talk about lesbians later. But it is Friday now, so we're a full week from the IRS revelations and, you know, 5-6 days from the AP revelations. And already what we're starting to get, and I think it's very interesting, is a universal discussion in the media of the Republicans better be careful to not push this too far.
Right.
Because they may overplay their hand, and they tried this with the Monica Lewinsky affair. No pun intended, and that didn't work well for them in that midterm election. So it's I think what we've got here is we're seeing the cycle now. We're seeing it shift. We saw them attack a little bit or criticize the administration, over the weekend and on Monday and on Tuesday. Now on Friday and yesterday, we're beginning to start hearing the Republicans better not go too far, or
right.
This is going to hurt them.
Right, and of course
that's what we're going to see unless we get more revelations that this really does go right to the top and the administration really did know and this came right from them. I think that's going to start being the pushback here. Republicans better be careful.
I agree. And, of course, I think the analogy is ridiculous, especially coming with someone who's called White House correspondent who should have a knowledge of history at least, even if he wasn't around back then. I mean, comparing as much as I thought it was legitimate to impeach Bill Clinton because it wasn't about sex. It was about lying under oath, perjury, the whole thing. But still, half the public felt it was his sex life. It's nobody's business. The public
right.
doesn't feel that way about the IRS or the media getting
right.
their records taken. So there's no analogy to be made there.
No, there really isn't, and I think you just raised a great point. I mean, a president having an affair in the Oval Office, there's a percentage of the population that says, so what? Okay, big deal. Why are they impeaching him over this? This is a waste of our time. Especially, remember, the economy was doing well, and people were really not, there was a percentage of the population not interested in this. But this is the IRS. There's 53% of the population that actually pays taxes. They're worried about this. Of course, that brings up, what are the other 47%? I mean, is it conceivable that there's a percentage of the population, since they don't pay taxes, they're going, who cares?
I don't
They'll
know.
Never come after me.
But there was a Rasmussen poll that came out the other day, and it was something like, it was either 53 or 57% said that they want to see somebody, suffer the consequences from this scandal. So we'll see. But I want to get to Dan Rather, who had his take on this. Again, another piece that you wrote at newsbusters.org. This will be 28, Will. Let's play 28.
Well, we're in the early stages, so it's a little early to start making a comparison.
Okay.
Those who compare it to Watergate, the Republicans are always eager to jump on almost anything and mm-hmm. say, well, it's like Watergate. We're not anywhere in the same cosmos as that. Because keep in mind with Watergate, while using the Internal Revenue Service to punish one's opponents, came directly from the president himself. That's a fact.
Right.
Now, in this case, we don't even know whether the president was aware that this was happening. But this is advantage Republican. The Republicans must be slapping high five behind closed doors because...
Yep. Yeah, slapping high five, baby.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting that he said that. I mean, look, to a certain extent, I mean, do we disagree that right now, and behind closed doors, you have to figure that Mitch McConnell and John Boehner and their underlings, their lieutenants, are, well, no one's pleased about a scandal.
No,
like
but
that,
they were handed
right?
a gift, a political right. gift. No one's glad that people were targeted right. by the IRS, but right. it is a political loser for the administration and Democrats, and a political winner for anybody who opposes it.
Yeah, I mean, look, we've got NBA playoffs and NHL playoffs going on right now. So if we put this in a political, in a sports perspective, right now, heading into the midterms, suddenly the GOP looks up 3-0 in a seven game series, and still playing at home. You know, they took the first two on the road. They're coming back for game four to sweep. To their home. So, but it's still interesting to see Dan Rather say that, because I mean, clearly he came out and he said, you know, this isn't Watergate yet, but this is pretty darn serious.
Yep.
When again, I mean, this is another one of those far left media folks who are at least being somewhat honest about, hey, this is a very serious scandal.
Right, and he, I don't think he was saying that it in a negative fashion towards Republicans. I think if it right. were the other way around, he probably says that because he knows Democrats would be high-fiving if it was a Republican administration.
That's right.
So I don't think
That's
it was
right.
a negative. But let's listen to David Letterman. No lesbian jokes this time around, but cut 21, Will. Here we go.
Have you folks been paying attention to what's going on in Washington? Neither have I.
Oh.
It's crazy. In a matter of like 6 weeks, three big scandals, and it looks like President Obama and all his buddies in the White House may go to prison. Finally, some good news for the Romney campaign.
Yes.
It's about time.
So worth it.
People always say this to me. They say, hey, Letterman, they say, why don't you make jokes about Obama? And I say, all right, I'll tell you why. Good question. And, oh, you want to know why? Okay. I don't make jokes about him because I don't want the FBI tapping my phone. Tapping my phone. That's why.
I mean, look, I can't stand David Letterman over his politics, but I got to tell you, you know, he's a comedian, I know, but there was a message there, I think, in his own way.
Oh, there's no question. And I mean, I think it was very interesting that he would admit that people come up to him and say, why don't you make jokes about Obama?
Yep.
Because
yep.
at Newsbusters, we've been talking about how, with the exception of Jay Leno, comedians have not wanted to make jokes about this president. Finally, we're getting Jon Stewart is beginning to do it, too. But what this shows you is, A, he's kind of admitting that he doesn't want to make jokes about Obama or hasn't in the past, but now he's willing to, and it shows you that even David Letterman, and David Letterman is part of the 53% of Americans
right,
that pays
taxes. Yeah.
He makes like $25 million a year
right.
or whatever the number is. He makes a lot of money. He pays a lot of taxes. He doesn't want him to be a target of a Republican president down the road. I tell you what,
we're going to leave it there because I'm okay. up against a hard break. But folks could read, that's your story at newsbusters.org. Folks should check it out. Have a great weekend, my friend. We thank you for your time as always.
Sounds good. Talk to you next
All
week.
All right, Noel Shepard, ladies and gentlemen, don't go away.
The Steve Malzberg Show. In 2013, half of your friends, family, and neighbors may lose their jobs. And you may be forced to watch helplessly as you are robbed of 90% of your life savings, all while your home's value is eradicated. Controversial economist Robert Wiedemer believes we will soon stare down a secret crisis that will rival the Great Depression. It was Wiedemer's 2005 book, America's Bubble Economy, that warned of coming meltdowns in our housing and stock markets. Washington did not heed his call, and folks on Main Street lost $50 trillion from the recession. His New York Times best-selling book, Aftershock, predicted our federal debt and dollar would be the next bubbles to burst. And now Robert Wiedemer has released a startling video with shocking evidence the powers that be have tried to ban. But that hasn't stopped 50 million people from getting the truth. Join us at aftershock2013.com aftershock2013.com.
Hi, this is Mike Reagan. Folks ask me, what would Ronald Reagan do if he were with us today? I believe the first thing he'd do is stop Obamacare. Already it's in effect with higher taxes, hidden fees, skyrocketing insurance rates, big Medicare cuts, and some insurance plans are hit with a 40% tax. Protect yourself by getting the Obamacare Survival Guide. It's already a number one New York Times bestseller. Newsmax says it's the best guide to the new law, giving you the strategies, tips, and loopholes you need to know. If you're insured on Medicare, a business owner, a medical professional, just about anyone, you need this book. Get the number one bestseller, The Obamacare Survival Guide, at bookstores everywhere. Or get our special $4.95 offer and save $15 off the cover price.
Scroll down now to claim your copy of Obamacare Survival Guide for the special internet offer of only $4.95.
Voice of talk radio is here. This is the Steve Malzberg Show. Call the show at 855-777-9660. Here is Steve.
And we are joined right now, folks, by someone who you know the name, you know the face. You know the face especially from when she was much younger than she is now, where she was a child star on Full House playing DJ Tanner. But of course, her movie career and film career has gone on and has been very successful. And this weekend on Saturday and Sunday at 7, 9, and 11 p.m. Eastern Time on GMC, you're going to be able to watch Candace Cameron Bure in a brand new movie called Finding Normal. Candace, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me, Steve.
Well, it's my pleasure. We'll talk about Finding Normal in a second, but I got so many things I want to ask you. First of all, how the heck did you succeed, and how did you manage to be where you are today, married with kids and successful and religious and still flourishing in your career where so many other child stars have wound up on a completely different path?
Only by the grace of God, and I mean that. I have great, wonderful parents who are very grounded, and I think they taught me well. And family's always been a priority and the focus of my life. And the work and the acting and all that is the fun stuff, like the extra fun stuff that I get to do. And I don't know. I guess I've managed to just keep it in perspective.
And now, I mean, you talked about by the grace of God and parents, and of course, both of those are very, very important.
Yes.
But you do talk openly about your Christian faith, correct?
Oh, yeah, I do. Absolutely. I've been speaking around the country at women's conferences and for about 10 years now, sharing my Christian faith and the message that's very important to me.
Well, you could go on with that because I'd like to hear it because, you know, it, especially in Hollywood, you know, we do a lot on this show about media bias and Hollywood. And I've had, you know, conservative people, actors who have said that, you know, their careers have, you know, been affected by their outspokenness and their political beliefs. And anybody who's a devout Christian and talks about it, I would imagine you probably have lost a role or two over the years.
You know what? I don't know that I probably have lost out on roles that I don't even realize when people are throwing my name around a room, you know, with a bunch of executives or something. But as far as my career, yes, there are lots of boundaries that I have and I choose my projects very, very specifically. But those are all choices that I've made for myself that I'm comfortable with and that I want to have. So I don't feel like I'm losing out on things, but it certainly narrows my options and limits me.
Do you feel, Candace, that in this country today it's more important than ever for someone like you, high profile, to go around the country and speak to the women's groups or any group, for that matter, about your faith?
I mean, I think it's relative at any time and any era. It's very important to me. And so that's why, I mean, it's something that I desire to do. I'm passionate about and I love. And I you know, it's such a huge part of my life that I don't know if I wouldn't want to do life without my faith. And because of that, it's exciting to me. And that's why I want to share it with the world.
Now, when you got married in 1996 to NHL star Valerie Bure, you actually, you know, did put your money where your mouth is, so to speak, and you cut your career short, and mm-hmm. you raised your kids mm-hmm. for a while, and then before going back, and I think that that's admirable. I know that my wife at the time, when we had our son, she was working actually in for Rush Limbaugh at the time, and she left mm-hmm. and raised our son, and I just think there's nothing more important than that. Do you think most women now nowadays are taught that that's not the thing to do, that they could have it all, and that if you depend on a man, or if you, you know, stay home and raise your kid and opt not to work, even if you can financially do that, that you're somehow you know, not living life to the fullest or not reaching your potential?
Well, I mean, certainly as women have risen in the corporate world, that message is very prevalent, and that's been around. But I think that there's a lot of people, a lot of women like me who are raised in a home as well, who truly put the importance on raising children and being a stay-at-home mom. So I think there's a lot of both around there. I think what women need to realize is that we all have different circumstances, and we're all unique. We're all given a unique nature, and some of us have a desire to work. Some of us have a stronger desire to not work and stay home with our children. And I think that both of those are okay. You can manage to do both. It's just that you might not be able to do both at the same time, because obviously, you know, not everything can be balanced and juggled perfectly 100% of the time. So for me, I realized I love being a working woman, but I couldn't do that when my children were younger. So I had to give one of those up. And of course, I chose my children, not work. But now that they're older, I'm able to go back to work. And my husband is retired from hockey, which makes it even better. And so it's realizing too that there are different seasons in life, and that's okay. And because the Joneses are doing something doesn't mean that I have to do it the same as them. And if we would just embrace one another and love and support one another that way more, I think women would have just enjoy all the aspects of life a lot more.
Very well said. All right, so let's talk about the movie Finding Normal, Saturday and Sunday on GMC. Mm-hmm. It's a family movie, which I think is right along the lines of what you would only do.
Exactly. I very much support family-friendly films, and it's what I want to be a part of. And so Finding Normal is a fish-out-of-water story. I play a very driven, kind of self-centered, self-focused woman, and I am taking this cross-country trip from LA to the Hamptons, and I get stuck in this teeny tiny town called Normal, and I have to serve out 3 days of community service for a fine that I'm not able to pay. So I'm in a whole different world, no credit cards, no lattes, no Wi-Fi, and yet as I get to know the people in this town, it really makes the character reevaluate her life and where her priorities are at, and whether or not the life that she has mapped out for herself is really the life she should be living.
Well, it sounds exciting and interesting. And again, Saturday and Sunday, 7, 9, and 11 p.m. Eastern Time on GMC. Candace, thank you very much. Nice talking to you.
All right, thanks for having me, Steve. Bye.
Candace Cameron Bure, ladies and gentlemen, former DJ Tanner on Full House way back when. All right, we're coming back. Don't go away. Steve Malzberg Show continues.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
My patients still don't know what Obamacare means for them. And how could they? There are already 13,000 pages of regulations, and the bureaucrats are just getting started. Obamacare will change your health care, and you need to understand how. There are hidden taxes and fines, big cuts in Medicare, even new regulations on what services doctors can offer you. Some businesses could get hit with a 40% additional tax on your health care plan. Please, get the Obamacare Survival Guide today. It's the best book explaining the new law. It's easy to read, everything you need to know to protect yourself, your family, your business. The Obamacare Survival Guide at bookstores everywhere.
Special internet-only offer right now at Obamacare911.com.
If your prostate is giving you problems and your doc says it's just part of getting older, be wary. Renowned physician and author Dr. David Brownstein thinks this is baloney. He's discovered a link between aging and prostate health and believes prostate concerns do not have to be an inevitable part of aging. That's why he created Prostate Revive.
Hi, I'm Dr. David Brownstein. I personally formulated Prostate Revive to include the most essential natural ingredients available to help promote a healthy prostate gland and optimal urinary function.
The producers of Dr. Brownstein's Prostate Revive are so thrilled with the positive feedback from satisfied customers that for a limited time, they are willing to send you your first month's supply free. Plus, call now and you'll also receive Dr. Brownstein's special report, A Doctor's Guide to a Healthy Prostate. For details on getting your free bottle, call 1-800-596-REVIVE. That's 1-800-596-REVIVE. Take control with Prostate Revive. Call now while supplies last to claim your risk-free bottle at 1-800-596-REVIVE. Revive.
Hello and welcome to your Newsmax Now update. I'm John Bachman. The man at the center of the IRS scandal faces tough questions from Congress today. Stephen Miller was fired this week for his role in the targeted scrutiny and auditing of conservative groups by the IRS. Miller was asked today why he did not come clean when certain members of Congress started poking around and looking into the unusually long wait times for Tea Party and other conservative groups to get their tax-exempt status. Miller claims that all political applicants receive scrutiny, and the unit overseeing these applications was undermanned.
Mr. Chairman, I did not mislead Congress nor the American people. I answered the questions as they were asked.
Meanwhile, the president has replaced Miller with White House budget official Danny Warfel. He'll hold the post until the end of September. And yet another member of the military's sexual harassment program is now in trouble. An Army lieutenant colonel, whose name was not released, headed up the Sex Assault Prevention Unit at Fort Campbell, Kentucky, but he was arrested after a domestic dispute with his wife. He has now been relieved of his duties. And on Thursday, President Obama met with top Pentagon leaders looking for a solution. After that, the chief of the Army issued a statement admitting that it is failing to combat sexual assault. There are high-profile cases like Lieutenant Colonel Jeffrey Kaczynski, the former head of the Sexual Assault Prevention Unit in the Air Force. He's now charged with groping a woman. And an Army sergeant at Fort Hood. He was also in charge of his unit's sexual assault prevention, but now he's under investigation for sexual assault and prostitution. And meteorologists say a total of 16 tornadoes slammed into North Texas Wednesday night, leaving six people dead in their wake. Homes of all shapes and sizes could not withstand winds of up to 200 miles per hour from a Wednesday tornado that hit in North Texas. It was an EF4, the second most powerful type. Meanwhile, 25 miles away, residents were sifting through debris and counting their blessings after a tornado struck there, but that tornado did not take any lives.
I mean, all of our children are safe. We're safe. Our house is demolished. Our cars are. But the most important thing's right here. I mean, honestly.
And coming up next on your Newsmax Now update, it's the world's largest flawless diamond. So how much was someone willing to pay to take it home? And violent protests in Turkey, just as the nation's prime minister meets with President Obama. See what sparked this outrage. And a Newsmax exclusive with Senator Marco Rubio, what the IRS scandal could mean for the Senate's immigration bill. That's next.
Have you ever wondered how you could make a difference in someone's life? What if you could help hundreds or even thousands of children? Students in the U.S. rank 32nd in world math skills. It's time for our children to catch up. Become an owner of one of the world's fastest growing franchises, Mathnasium. Mathnasium is the leading math-only learning center in the U.S. Imagine helping hundreds, even thousands of students in your community improve in school and raise their self-esteem. Call us at 800-676-5216. 800-676-5216.
Hi, this is Mike Reagan. Folks ask me, what would Ronald Reagan do if he were with us today? I believe the first thing he'd do is stop Obamacare. Already it's in effect with higher taxes, hidden fees, skyrocketing insurance rates, big Medicare cuts, and some insurance plans are hit with a 40% tax. Protect yourself by getting the Obamacare Survival Guide. It's already a number one New York Times bestseller. Newsmax says it's the best guide to the new law, giving you the strategies, tips, and loopholes you need to know. If you're insured on Medicare, a business owner, a medical professional, just about anyone, you need this book. Get the number one bestseller, The Obamacare Survival Guide, at bookstores everywhere. Or get our special $4.95 offer and save $15 off the cover price by going now to Obamacare911.com. Obamacare911.com. That's Obamacare911.com.
Last chance now at 23 million.
And welcome back. This is the world's largest flawless diamond, and it was just sold at auction this week. The pear-shaped stone is about the size of a golf ball and weighs just over 100 carats. The price tag? $26.7 million. It was purchased by the Harry Winston Jewelry Group. And in Turkey, protesters clashed with police over two bombing attacks on the border with Syria that killed dozens of people. The protesters say the Turkish government and other countries around the world are not doing enough to deal with the massive amount of Syrian refugees crossing the border. Some believe the refugees include jihadists and fighters loyal to the Assad regime, and that's why they may have been targeted by these bombings. Four people, all Turks, have been arrested for the attacks. This all comes as the Turkish prime minister just wrapped up a visit at the White House. And with four congressional committees looking into the IRS scandal, we should find out what the White House knew and when. And during a recent Newsmax exclusive interview, Senator Marco Rubio says that no matter what the White House knew or didn't know, this and other scandals are symptoms of the president's faulty leadership.
The fundamental problem, and I called for that, by the way, earlier in the week, the fundamental problem here is this culture of intimidation. It's basically this. You have a president, an administration, and a political apparatus around him who has decided that the way to win the political battles of the day is to destroy your political opponents, to basically impugn their motives, to talk bad about them, to convince people that they're bad people.
And to see the rest of this interview and more of our exclusive content, stay with Newsmax.com. This has been your Newsmax Now update for May the 17th. I'm John Bachman. Now here's the Steve Malzberg Show in New York.
Microphones hot, satellite link established, studio lights illuminated, cameras rolling, audio and video encoders firing ones and zeros, internet stream streaming. The most technology advanced radio show is on the air. Here's the captain of this enterprise, Steve Malzberg.
Yes, just in case you forgot, I have been promoted to captain. It is Friday, final hour of the Steve Malzberg Show for the week. And to kick it off, we are joined by Kevin Williamson, National Review contributor, author of the brand new book, The End is Near, and it's going to be awesome. How Going Broke Will Leave America Richer, Happier, and More Secure. Here it is, and here is Kevin. Kevin, welcome.
Hi, thanks.
Appreciate it. Move that a little bit closer to you, and we'll be all set. Okay. First of all, did you see any of the hearings today?
I didn't see a lot of them. Unfortunately, I had a lot of other stuff going on today. But the whole thing with the IRS is just extraordinarily troubling, regardless of whether it goes back to the White House.
Well, yeah, and but there is a story that that's come out because of testimony today. The Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration testified and told members of the Ways and Means that he informed the Treasury's General Counsel of his audit on June 4th, and this goes back to 2012. The Treasury Department Inspector General said that he was auditing the IRS's screening of politically active organizations, told the Treasury back in June of 2012. I mean, it gets more and more unlikely, harder to believe that the administration, that the president did not know this was going on until last Friday.
Yeah, that's really the unbelievable thing about this is all the leadership says they didn't know about it, but everyone's lawyers knew about it. Everyone's general counsel, everyone's senior counsel was getting reports on this, was having meetings about it, you know, changing the standards, changing the wording, that sort of thing. So I find it really, really unlikely that the commissioner of the IRS didn't know it, that people at senior in the Treasury Department didn't know it. Now, I'd be surprised to see if any of this was being directed by the president personally or anyone in his immediate circle, because they just don't do that sort of thing. It's like when you're at the top of an organized crime syndicate, you know, you never touch drugs or money.
I love the analogy.
But there are people who do it on your behalf.
Right, but you know that it's going on. I mean, you know that your organization, your syndicate, is involved in drugs and crime and all that kind of stuff. You may not make the decisions. You may not be told. You know, you may not be. They may insulate you so that you can never be fingered or never be culpable legally. But you know that that's happening because you're head of the crime syndicate.
Right. In a sense, it's more troubling if no one told the IRS to do this because they didn't really have to be told to do it. Just targeting people who belong to Tea Party groups, targeting people who care about the Bill of Rights or Constitution, just apparently sort of comes naturally to them, whether anyone above them was telling them to do it or not.
Yeah. A very troubling day because we had Stephen Miller say that when asked directly if targeting of individuals and groups is against the law, he said he doesn't believe it's against the law. He had no information when it came to who okayed this, who put it in motion, who were there. Give us names. He had no names. He did apologize, but he's very arrogant. Basically, as a nice segue into your book, said, you know, we need more funding at the IRS because our guys are overworked. And this is really this was a time saver. This was a code words were instituted to look for to save time, to help us shuffle through and get through all the the thousands of applications. So here again, he's using this as a pitch for more money. Talk about what you talk about in your book. I love the title is brilliant. The end is near, and it's going to be awesome.
Well, if you look at the debt, the deficits, the unfunded liabilities of the federal, state, and local governments, you add them all up, you get a number that looks around $140 trillion, which is about two times the GDP of the planet. It's pressing up against the value of all the financial assets in the world. So everyone knows that our current trajectory is not sustainable. Democrats know it, Republicans know it, Libertarians know it, the CBO knows it. Everyone knows it. So the current trajectory we're on is not going to be where we are in a few years. The promises we've made for things like Social Security, Medicare just simply aren't going to be paid. One of the reasons I worry less about Obamacare than a lot of people do is I don't think it'll ever actually be implemented fully because we simply don't have the money for it. So the question we need to be asking ourselves, I think, as conservatives, as free market people, is once these programs go away, which they're going to because the money just simply is not there, what do we do to address those problems after that? Because, you know, there's always going to be a problem with how do we take care of health care for very poor people? How do we take care of education? We don't really expect kids to be financially responsible for themselves. We've got some real social problems and social challenges that we need to address that the welfare state isn't doing a very good job of addressing. So this book is in part about how we go about thinking about how to solve those problems.
Well, let's talk about Obamacare for a second. On a political note, the woman who was in charge of the the tax-exempt groups, not only she's gotten herself a promotion.
Yeah.
She is going to be the one. She is in charge of the department of the IRS that will be responsible for implementing Obamacare. That's one problem. But, you know, you talk about it not being able to be fully implemented. It's just already caused so much chaos. It's got doctors, you know, ready to leave, and they're leaving. It's got hospitals revamping. It's got the premiums going up. It's got employers not hiring. I mean, it's already created such a chaotic scene that whether it's fully implemented or not, they're saying next year, one congressional report said that that the premiums could go up next year 200, 300, 400%.
Yeah.
How's this country going to deal with that?
Yeah, and it's one of the things I get into in the book is this, you know, traditional Washington approach of taking a one-size-fits-all, one big piece of legislation and solving, as they say, something really complex like health care doesn't introduce order into the marketplace. It introduces chaos. It introduces a great deal of uncertainty. And Obamacare is a classic Washington example of that, where you take a very vague piece of legislation, you hand it over to the bureaucrats to develop the regulations to implement it, and nobody knows which way they're going with it. It's what political scientists call regime uncertainty. You don't know what sort of environment you're going to be operating in, what the regulations are going to look like, what the taxes are going to look like, what the laws are going to look like. And so nobody can make intelligent investment decisions from there, whether it's a company deciding to develop a line of medical products or someone deciding whether to go to med school.
And this has been the case right from the time that they were talking about Obamacare, thinking it would be implemented. And then once it was passed, that has been the mindset for business owners, large and small. Uncertainty is an economic killer.
Yeah, and it's especially troubling because the whole problem with our approach to these sorts of things is throwing government appropriations at a particular set of problems without paying any attention to the supply side of the equation. So you can spend $1 trillion on healthcare next year. You can spend $50 trillion, whatever you want to. If there are only so many doctors, so many hospital beds, so many factories making artificial hips, so many factories making pharmaceuticals, all you're going to get is inflation. All you're going to get is a bigger pool of money chasing the same supply of goods and services. What we need to do is encourage real investment in real medical assets, whether those are factories, hospitals, or young people going into careers in medicine. And instead, we're discouraging all of that.
Absolutely. We're talking right now to Kevin Williamson from National Review and his book, The End Is Near, and it's going to be awesome. How going broke will leave America richer, happier, and more secure. You know, we've all heard about the doomsday scenario that we're going to become Greece. Mm. We're going to become, you know, these countries that are going bankrupt, and you know, the next thing they'll come after are our pensions. And you hear about proposals that might, you know, that are on the table, that are floating around Congress, that you know, IRAs, the government should be able to borrow against them, et cetera. So where does it go before it gets better? In other words, how much more of a downside is there if we were to continue in a, I mean, the, you know, the market is running in the other direction of, from the economy, even though numbers look better jobs-wise and all. Still, I know, and you know, I believe, that you would agree with me, I can't want to put words in your mouth, that unemployment's down because people are leaving the workforce. Right. And there's a lesser participation rate than there's been in decades. So the numbers and the trends are all going worse. Housing starts, you know, fluctuate. But my point is, and my question, I guess, is, are we still headed in, distractions notwithstanding, are we still headed in that, you know, Greece direction, and can we wind up there before it gets better?
Yeah, the labor force thing is particularly troubling. We have fewer people working today than any time since Jimmy Carter was president. I'm just barely old enough to remember Jimmy Carter being president.
Yeah, don't remind me that he was president.
You know? So it's not like it was the day before yesterday. What is coming economically for us is going to come regardless of who's in the White House, who's in Congress, and what they do. The trouble that we have is baked into the cake, and there's no way to undo it. Now, we can either go into this process in an intelligent way, start doing some reforms now to make it less painful and less economically and socially disruptive, or we can keep doing what we're doing and go into it and have a quick, ugly, deep crisis. In which case, you know, Greece isn't even the worst case scenario. You've got, you know, places like Cyprus and Argentina that give you pretty good models of what you can do with that. So at some point, our government's ability to borrow money is limited by reality, not by the statutory debt ceiling, but by the real debt ceiling of what people are willing to do. And you don't want to discover in a very quick way where that is, where you have a bond auction and no one buys them.
Right.
And then you've got, you know, an immediate fiscal problem, an immediate monetary problem.
When China turns off the faucet, in effect.
Yeah, well, and that's a really worrisome thing to me because, you know, the Chinese economy is not nearly as strong as we think it is. It's not a house of cards, but it's definitely got some really troubling aspects to it. They've got their own real estate boom. They've got a banking system that's got all sorts of bad assets on the thing. So if China takes a real bad downturn, that's, you know, that's a real issue for us. We are linked together in a way that nobody likes very much, but is the way it is.
Let's talk about immigration and how that affects your scenario in the book and the future of this country. If it passes, and I was speaking to Senator Corker today, and he said that all these scandals certainly will make people look even harder at any kind of a administration effort to get anything done. And I hope that's true with immigration. If it passes, if some kind of reform passes, and you got, you know, the predictions are tens of millions of people coming into this country over the next decade, could be 20 million, 30 million, if family members are invited, et cetera. High-end workers, skilled workers will be invited, low-end workers will be invited, and we already have people who don't work now in this country. Does that contribute to the... does that expedite your scenario, or does that throw a monkey wrench into it, or what?
No, you know, this is a classic example of what I'm talking about in the book, is we often spend a lot of time talking about what government should do, but we don't often ask what it can do. We have perfectly good immigration laws, but they don't get enforced.
Right.
So federal incompetence means that instead of having 15 or 16 or 17 million new immigrants who are people with MBAs and engineering degrees and doctors and highly skilled, highly educated, very, very economically valuable people, we've got 15 million people who are farm workers and dishwashers and, you know, very poor, very unskilled people from Latin America. I don't resent them for coming here. If I was in their spot, I would do exactly the same thing. But a country has to tell itself, well, we can't take every immigrant in the world, so what criteria do we use to accept them, instead of doing it on an economic basis, which would be rational and reasonable and also more fair. You know, we've got educated and capable people from all over the world, from Asia, from Africa, from Latin America and Europe and everywhere else. And if you do that, you have some real economic criteria, real skills and education criteria, then you make it a reasonably fair process. Instead, we make it impossible for smart, highly educated people to come here. We make it really easy for people who are willing to break the law to come here, so we end up getting the worst of both worlds. I'm generally very pro-immigration, and I think it's one piece of the puzzle for fixing the situation we're in. But what we're doing right now in immigration is absolutely counterproductive.
I couldn't agree with you more. Okay, before we let you go, Kevin, you had a little incident in a theater attending a performance of Natasha Pierre and the Great Comet of 1812, and you wound up taking someone's cell phone and throwing it?
I did. Yeah, you know, this is funny. Never mind the books I've written and my work at National Review.
This has got, now you're worldwide famous.
This is what the world is going to know me for, apparently. So I am the theater critic at the New Criterion, and I was at a play the other night. It's actually an opera. It's about a 2.5-hour opera based on War and Peace. Not the place to be if you have a short attention span. Yeah. So there was a lady sitting next to me who was just on her phone the whole time. You know, we complained to the management about it during the intermission, but it didn't help. So I asked her very politely to knock it off because, you know, it's a darkened theater and a bright phone and all the rest of it. And
plus, she's talking. Who the heck wants to hear someone else
and
talking?
Talking to her friends. Yeah. She wasn't actually talking on the phone. She was texting while talking to her friends in the theater,
which was even worse. Yeah.
And so she said, well, if you don't like it, look somewhere else. And I was thinking, well, you know, I would actually, except that this is bright light shining in my face. So anyway, when it became clear she wasn't going to comply, I took the phone away from her. And I tossed it into the wings. I was aiming for a door. I was trying to throw it out the door. I didn't actually hit the door. I'm not a very good shot, apparently. So it became this whole
So what happened to you? What was the result of that?
The funny thing was she
did
stood
her
up.
Husband, like, get up and slug you?
There was no husband there.
Okay. That's always
but
good.
But she stood up and slugged me. Well, she slapped me anyway. But then the theater, the way this particular play was going on, it's not the actors aren't on a stage. They're sort of in the middle of the venue. So she got up and marched out through the middle of the production, which apparently a number of people thought was part of the show, and, you know, opened the doors behind her. So eventually they kicked me out. And,
I was going to say, and what about her phone? Are you going to have to pay for it or anything?
Well, I haven't heard anything about that yet. Apparently, she was talking to someone, the manager there, about, you know, calling the police and filing charges. I haven't been hauled off yet, but I just like to say if I am, I'm okay with that. It will have been worth it.
Oh, boy. Well, listen, best of luck with the book. Kevin Williamson will read you on National Review. And the book, The End Is Near, folks, available wherever fine books are sold, Amazon and all the bookstores, et cetera. And very interesting conversation. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, folks, we're coming back. It's Friday, and it's the final hour of the Steve Malzberg Show. Don't go away.
The Steve Malzberg Show. Attention, if you've been classified as a high-risk driver due to DUI, DWI, or tickets for aggressive driving and are required to get expensive and hard-to-find SR-22 auto insurance, then you must listen to this message because we can help. We're the largest insurance company in the U.S., specializing in SR-22 auto insurance and focused on serving the needs of customers classified by the state as high-risk drivers. We help people get back on their feet by providing easy-to-get, low-cost SR-22 insurance that anyone can afford. If you need SR-22 auto insurance, or if you have it now and are paying too much, you need to call us today for your free quote at 800-836-4606. Our specialists are standing by waiting for your call. We understand people make mistakes, and we're here to help by making SR-22 insurance easy to get and affordable for everyone. The call and quote are free. Call us now at 800-836-4606. That's 800-836-4606. Again, 800-836-4606.
This is a referral service. Calls will be routed to an independent referral insurance agency.
Do you know the number one cause of bankruptcy? No, it's not losing your job or running up credit card debt. It's not even divorce. It's medical costs. If you and your family don't have health insurance, just one serious illness or accident could be financially devastating. But now there's good news, really good news. A health insurance hotline has been established to provide health insurance for all Americans, even uninsured Americans with pre-existing conditions. Now anyone can get health insurance even if you have a pre-existing medical condition. I repeat, now anyone can get health insurance coverage. Call now for a free no-obligation quote on affordable health plans available to you. Again, this is a free hotline for anyone, even if you have pre-existing conditions. Protect you and your family from sudden unexpected medical costs. Call the free health insurance hotline right now at 1-800-910-3470. That's 1-800-910-3470. Call 1-800-910-3470.
Are payday loans ruining your life? If you have two or more payday loan cash advances, listen closely. You may be eligible for a program that payday loan companies don't want you to know about.
This program will get payday loan companies out of your bank account and put an end to the payday loan nightmare. Call for free information and find out if Payday Loan Support Center is right for you. Payday loan companies usually trap you into paying rates as high as 700%. We understand payday lenders' tactics. Don't let them take advantage of you anymore. All you need is two or more payday loans to qualify. We can help even if you're behind in collections or have bad credit.
Internet payday loans qualify for this program as well. So call 800-250-5084. That's 800-250-5084. The call is free and the consultation is free. Don't miss out. Call for your free information on payday loan relief. 800-250-5084. That's 800-250-5084. Again, 800-250-5084.
Hi, I'm Joan London, and if you're worried about your parent or a loved one living alone like I was, and you want reliable senior care information, then call A Place for Mom, the nation's largest senior living referral service. You'll get free information on assisted living, Alzheimer's care, nursing homes, even important financial information.
They had obviously researched every place, not just given me names.
Really? Yeah.
They found me a place for what she could afford, and it was magnificent.
We're now very confident that she's safe, and they just helped every step of the way, and I can't thank them enough.
So if you're struggling to find reliable senior living information, call A Place for Mom. This is a free service, and you can trust them to help you.
If you're struggling to find reliable senior living information for your mom or dad, then call or go online to get the free help you need during this turbulent time. Call now, 800-908-1254, 800-908-1254.
The new voice of talk radio is here. This is the Steve Malzberg Show. Call the show at 855-777-9660. Here is Steve.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. I want to let you know what was confirmed today. During the course of the show, we played various testimony from Stephen Miller, the arrogant outgoing head of the IRS, interim head of the IRS. But we did not play you any sound yet from J. Russell George, the Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration. And he testified today as well. And he testified that that he had told senior Treasury Department officials back in June of last year, June of 2012, before the election, this administration knew that the IRS was being screened. He was auditing the IRS's screening of potentially active organizations, politically active organizations seeking tax exemptions. So this is the first time that it's been disclosed officially that the Obama administration officials were aware of the matter during the presidential campaign. Yet this president claimed yesterday, sidestepped the question about whether or not he knew that this was an ongoing practice in the IRS, and said with regard to the Inspector General's review that he knew nothing about it until Friday, last Friday. How on earth is this possible? You mean Geithner found out, but he didn't tell Obama? I mean, are we supposed to believe this? Is that what we're supposed to believe? This is going to, as Paul Ryan said, that raises a big question. And David Kemp, the representative from Michigan, the chairman of the House Ways and Means, said this appears just to be the latest example of a culture of cover-ups and political intimidation in this administration. It seems like the truth is hidden from the American people just long enough to make it through an election. This is Max Baucus himself, the Democrat who's outgoing from the U.S. Senate, said just today or yesterday that a lot more is coming from this IRS scandal. Folks, don't be surprised if it does. When we come back, a very interesting interview with two Olympian swimmers, one former, one present, about keeping your kids safe in the water. We did the interview yesterday. Give a listen and watch. It's worth it.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
You've heard the allegations on the news and during the big game. Pro football players have been using deer antler velvet to get a competitive edge. Banned at the London Games for its performance-enhancing qualities. Forbidden in major sports leagues for being an unfair advantage to athletes. Deer antler velvet is now in stock and available to try for free for a limited time only. Athletes have been using it for years for increased strength, increased endurance, muscle mass stress reduction, and yes, greatly enhanced libido. Everyone's talking about this miracle substance so powerful it's being banned by professional sports organizations, but for a limited time, it's being made available to the general public. Best of all, you can try it for free by calling 800-678-5153. That's right, get Superior Velvet for free. If you're looking to boost your performance on the field and between the sheets, get the most powerful, proven product used by athletes for years now for free. Claim your free bottle today by calling 800-678-5153. That's 800-678-5153. Again, 800-678-5153.
Hello, my name is Fred Flights, and I'm the managing editor of LigNet. You've probably seen our name preceding some of the stories you read on Newsmax or heard LigNet referenced on Fox News, C-SPAN, or CNN. Perhaps you've asked yourself, what is LigNet? LigNet is an acronym for the Langley Intelligence Group Network, a private Washington, D.C.-based service that provides global intelligence, in-depth analysis, and detailed forecasting. LigNet's staff and advisors include former CIA officers, national security experts, presidential advisors, and top-level government officials from around the world. I myself held several national security posts for the U.S. government during my 25-year career with the Central Intelligence Agency, the Defense Intelligence Agency, the U.S. Department of State, and the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence. Our lead advisor is General Michael Hayden, the former director of the CIA. He is joined by former U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, John Bolton, and former chairman of the National Intelligence Council and special assistant to President Ronald Reagan, Fritz Ehrmann, former U.S. Ambassador to Venezuela, Otto Reich, and former clandestine service officer, Frederick Russman, former chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, Peter Hoekstra, also join our advisory board staff. Every day, our goal is to use our expertise, our resources, and our worldwide staff to take the pulse of the ever-changing political and economic landscape and the threats we face on a daily basis. Whether you are following global events for your portfolio or business, or just interested in the world around you, LigNet provides what you need to know to keep up with global events. There are many. Every day, LigNet members receive the Morning Brief, a daily email that provides summaries and links to our daily analysis to keep you up to date on LigNet's assessments. LigNet members receive unrestricted access to LigNet's secure database of global analysis. All of our special reports, previous analyses, and exclusive video interviews with intelligence insiders are available to members 24 hours a day. But you also get top-notch analysis that resembles the President's Daily Brief, the classified intelligence assessment delivered to the President of the United States every morning. LigNet also sends breaking news emails to our membership list. If there is a development of global proportions or a terror alert, our subscribers are always the first to know. I hope you now have a better understanding of what LigNet is, but more importantly, recognize how truly invaluable LigNet can be. As the old saying goes, knowledge is power.
Join LigNet for $1. Go to lignet.com.
Are you tired of the insanity in talk radio? Well, there's a new voice during the afternoon. This is the Steve Malzberg Show.
And ladies and gentlemen, we are joined right now by two Olympians, two champions, gold medal winners in the pool, in the swimming area. And we have four-time medalist Cullen Jones, fresh off his three-medal performance, including a gold at the 2012 Olympic Games. And we have Rowdy Gaines, who you are, a lot of you are probably just familiar with him for his work on ESPN, NBC, TNT, and at swimming meets and Olympics, et cetera. But, of course, he is a three-time gold medal winner in the 1984 Games. And, gentlemen, welcome to both of you.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Now, you guys are doing something very important here, and that is, you want to teach kids how to swim because kids drown, and we're entering the summer months and it's pool season and swimming season, and you know, there's hardly a greater tragedy than when you hear about these kids climbing into a pool or just being swept away or whatever the situation is. And if I can start with you, Colin.
Sure.
You had an experience of your own at the age of five. Talk about that.
Yes, I was about 5 years old, and I was a spoiled little only child, and my parents wanted to bring me to an amusement park, and I was excited, and they had water rides, and my parents decided they wanted to get on one of them, and I was fully supervised. That's what's important about this story. There were lifeguards there, my parents were there, and I still was able to go underwater, flip on the inner tube, and it takes about 20 seconds for a child to drown, and I was underwater for 30.
Wow, and you obviously were rescued.
They resuscitated me, yes.
And how did you ever want to get back in the water?
I was a little nervous to get back in the water, but I had two parents that really were pushing for it. My dad didn't know how to swim, my mom didn't, but she was kind of the driving force about wanting to make sure that I learned how to swim because she herself didn't know how to swim.
And Rowdy, how did you get involved with this Make a Splash, which is what this organization is called, which is trying to educate kids and teach them how to swim?
Well, I worked for USA Swimming many years ago, 2003, and we started the USA Swimming Foundation, and the Make a Splash was sort of driving out of that. What we do is it's a national water safety initiative that we spread the message of water safety throughout the country. Steve, there. Drowning, as you said, it's an epidemic in our country. It's the second leading cause of accidental death in children ages 14 years and younger. And through Make a Splash, through USA Swimming Foundation, our great partner, Phillips 66, we're able to spread this message through our some 600 partner programs all across the country.
And no, that there's, like I said, it's so important because you hate to hear about those things. But what could parents listening right now, aside from getting involved with Make a Splash and attending your events and going to the website, all that, but what could they do? I mean, what do you advise first and foremost that parents with young children 14 and under do with regard to water safety?
I would say the number one thing is to understand that children are naturally drawn to the water. Once it starts getting warm next week, Memorial Day, pools start opening, kids are going to want to be near the pool. But like Rowdy said, this is a life skill. This is something that children need to learn how to do because they're going to get around water once it starts to get warm. So make sure that they know that it's fun, but they need to be smart about how they approach the water. They need to respect it and to be safe around it. Never swim alone, always have fun, but respect the water.
And Steve, let me say one more thing on that. You know, if you go to the website, it's makeasplash.org, a lot of people are concerned about money, the cost of it. Right. I mean, when you think about some of our underprivileged communities, it's a real problem. And 70% of, for example, African Americans don't know how to swim. 60% of Hispanic children don't know how to swim. But if you go to that website, it'll list the 600 programs across the country in every state. And a lot of these programs give low cost or even free swim lessons to kids. So money should not be an object.
Right. All right, we're talking to Rowdy Gaines, triple Olympic gold medalist, and Cullen Jones, who just won Olympic gold and two other medals in the 2012 Olympics, and I know he's planning to compete in the 2016 Olympic Games in Rio.
Yes.
Let me ask you, Cullen, about being only the second African American male ever to make the U.S. swim team. You know, there's a terrible stereotype about blacks not being able to swim or whatever. Why do you think there's such a paucity of, or has been such a paucity of blacks on the U.S. Olympic swim team? Is it because they don't try out, or is it because they don't make it? And that always gets me when I hear statistics like here in New York City. Oh, only 3% of the fire force is African American, and that's not right. It's prejudice. And I say, well, how many applied? I mean, you got to tell me how many are applying before you tell me it's prejudice. So, what's the deal with the paucity of African Americans and swimming, at least as regard to the Olympic team?
Well, Steve, I think it's a cultural thing. You know, I've had people in my own family growing up. They're like, "You're still doing that swimming thing," and they just I know the African Americans in the U.S. It's kind of been beaten into our heads that this is something that we don't do. But there's an answer to that. We didn't play golf. We didn't play tennis. but we do now. Once I feel like someone is a trailblazer, you see more and more people kind of being able to stand behind that. And I think that there have been people before me. I think right now I have the torch. There are people that I will be handing that to. And I think you'll see a lot more African Americans on the Olympic team, just because this is ground that many people haven't stepped on. This is something that is new. This is something that is different. And for some, it scares. And for many, I think there are people that are going that route. And I'm happy to be a part of a small group of people, but a group of people that will be going after that Olympic gold in swimming.
No, and Rowdy, I'd like to just mention you. I am, this is basically a political show, although my background is sports, and we do sports from time to time. And, of course, the 1980 Olympic Games, which you had planned to participate in, the boycott affected you at the peak of your career. We did not go to those Olympics, and but you did shine, of course, in 84, the L.A. Games 4 years later. There is no real separation, a way to separate politics and sports, especially when it comes to the Olympics, as we've seen, I guess, throughout the Olympic history, correct?
I wish there was, Steve. I sure wish there was, but there isn't, unfortunately. And when if you go back to 1980, the problem I had with it was it was such an utter failure. The people that didn't have the foresight to see that, A, the boycott wasn't going to work because the Russians were still going to have an Olympic Games, and B, it was still going to be held in Moscow. They should have seen that going down the pipe. And that affected a lot of athletes. As you said, I came out smelling like the rose because I had 1984, but there were 300 and something athletes of that 80 team that didn't swim in 76 and didn't swim in 84, didn't compete in all sports. And those are the ones that I really feel for.
Yeah, and of course, let me ask you one question also about the Olympics here. The refusal of the Olympic Committee to honor or recognize the slaughter of the Israeli athletes in 72, the families have requested it, others have requested it to have some kind of memorial. Actually, the 40th anniversary just passed, and they again refused to do it. You feel that should be acknowledged at a Games?
Well, once again, it becomes political when you do that, Steve. I mean, I want the Olympic Games to be about the competition, you know, and yes, there definitely needs to be something to honor that, because that was a huge tragedy. Whether or not that happens at an Olympic Games, I don't know, but it needs to happen. And I understand the feelings of that. I was 13 years old in 1972. I remember that. That Olympics inspired me to swim. Mark Spitz was a big swimmer in that Olympic Games. So
we're the same age. Yeah, we're the same age.
Yep. I was 13. I was in 72. That was one of the big things that inspired me. So, and it was also a huge tragedy and something that I'll never forget. And hopefully the world will never forget.
All right. Listen, gentlemen, Rowdy Gaines, Cullen Jones, makeasplash.org. Everybody, to keep your kids safe from swimming. Thank you for joining us, guys.
Thanks.
All right, folks. Very, very good cause and very important. You don't want accidents to happen when they don't have to happen. And kids, Rowdy said, are drawn to water. Better safe than sorry, at the very least. All right, we're going to come back. We're going to continue right here on the Steve Malzberg Show.
The Steve Malzberg Show.
A tragic fire, a break-in, a fall. Look, accidents and emergencies really do happen. The difference between life and death could be as simple as the push of a button. That's where Medical Guardian comes in. Are you afraid that something tragic may happen with no one around to help? What if you or your elderly loved one had a fall and lay for hours or even days before any help arrived? What if it was just too late? You don't have to live in fear that something terrible could happen. It's time you discovered Medical Guardian. Life-saving help at the push of a button. Get the peace of mind you need for yourself and your loved ones. Call 800-550-3470 right now. Be one of the first 100 callers and get your first month of Medical Guardian free. 800-550-3470. Call now and get your first month for free. The help you need is at your fingertips. Ensure your safety today with Medical Guardian. 800-550-3470. That's 800-550-3470.
Are you at least 62 years old like me? Could you use an extra $50,000, $100,000 or more to live a better life? Then please consider the benefits a reverse mortgage can provide to you. With a reverse mortgage, you can have your mortgage payments stopped altogether and get equity out of your home to live on. And you can use the money to help you live a better life. How nice would that be, not to have a mortgage payment? Qualifying for a reverse mortgage is simple, since there are no income, asset, employment, or credit requirements. However, you must be 62 years or older, own your home outright, or have a very low balance on the mortgage, and be prepared to live in it throughout the rest of the loan. Call now for more information.
800-831-1560. 800-831-1560. 800-831-1560. That's 800-831-1560.
Attention hip implant patients. Are you in constant pain? Have you received a letter from your doctor about your implant? Have you had or need a revision surgery? Do you have high levels of metal, chromium, or cobalt in your blood? Over 90,000 hip implant devices have been recalled due to defects and failures resulting in revision or replacement surgery. If you have a recalled hip implant, you may be entitled to substantial financial compensation. Call 800-460-1530 to see if your implant is affected by the recalls. If you or a loved one has a defective or recalled hip implant, you may be entitled to substantial financial compensation. Call 800-460-1530. That's 800-460-1530. Protect your legal rights today. Call 800-460-1530.
This is an advertisement, not valid in all states. Paid non-attorney spokesperson. iLawsuit.com is an advertising group that represents lawyers advertising their services and is a free matching service for consumers. It is not a law firm or lawyer referral service.
Do you owe the IRS? Do you have unfiled tax returns? Have you received a wage garnishment or bank levy? Maybe a lien has been filed against you. OMG Tax can help you with all your IRS tax problems. Don't wait another second. Take action now. Call my team at OMG Tax. Honest and professional, we don't make false promises. If you owe back taxes or if the IRS is garnishing your paycheck, you need help now. OMG Tax can help you get your life back to normal. If you're serious about handling your tax matter, call OMG Tax now and get the peace of mind you deserve. Don't let the IRS take your next paycheck. Stop waiting and call our team at OMG Tax. OMG Tax has a straightforward, no-nonsense approach and has helped many Americans resolve their IRS nightmare. Call OMG Tax now.
Call 1-800-255-6485. That's 1-800-255-6485. 800-255-6485.
3 a.m. and you're up again for the third time. It's not just affecting your sleep, it's interrupting your daily life. Frequent trips to the bathroom due to an aging prostate is a common concern, but you can now do something about it with Prostate Revive. Doctor-formulated Prostate Revive is an all-natural dietary supplement packed with 15 powerful ingredients focused on improving prostate health by targeting the two main sources of prostate concerns, rogue testosterone and inflammation. And now, in this limited-time radio offer, you can try Prostate Revive absolutely free. That's a free bottle, a 30-day supply of Prostate Revive, risk-free. Plus, if you call right now, you'll also receive our free report, A Doctor's Guide to a Healthy Prostate. Call now for details on getting your free bottle, plus our doctor's report. Call 1-800-659-REVIVE. That's 1-800-659-REVIVE. Don't be a victim of an aging prostate. Start getting the sleep you need and get your life back with Prostate Revive. Claim your risk-free bottle now at 1-800-659-REVIVE. Revive.
The new voice of talk radio is here. This is the Steve Malzberg Show. Call the show at 855-777-9660. Here is Steve.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Steve Malzberg Show. I see another almost 2-mile-long asteroid is going to come close to the Earth on May 31st, so here we go again. We'll keep you updated on that as we get a little bit closer to it. This is the final segment of the week. It has been a crazy week. It's been a very revealing day at the hearings. Just to summarize, the outgoing head of the IRS and the inspector general who did the report. Turns out the inspector general told the administration, told the Treasury Department about his audit of the IRS for their improper behavior June of 2012. It was kept a secret by the administration until by the IRS. It was held by the IRS until last Friday, okay? You can't tell me that little Timmy tax cheat Geithner did not know about this investigation and that he didn't tell the president. You cannot tell me that when we have heard reports of these abuses for years that the president had no idea any of this was going on. You cannot tell me that that is the case. Today, we heard from the outgoing head of the IRS, the outgoing interim head, Stephen Miller, that he was sorry, but basically his agents were overworked and they need more money for the agency. And they were looking for shortcuts to do work more efficiently and get more done. That's why they put key target words and those words raised red flags. He was asked about who ordered these targets. He took exception to the word targets. He didn't like the word targets. He was arrogant. He had no names for the congressman. He could not name one single person who signed off on this, who ordered it, whose idea it was to go after conservative groups and other groups. No names. And also, when asked specifically by Congressman Tom Price, is it against the law, in your view, for the IRS to target individuals or certain groups, at, you know, whose philosophies are of a certain nature, whatever? And he said to him, no. It's not against the law. What country are we living in? What country are we living in? Let me tell you something. This is going to get very, very ugly for the administration. Do we have 23? I don't want to throw you a curve. Tell me when we have it, Will. And it's going to get very ugly for the administration, notwithstanding garbage like this.
He felt good about it because he was doing the thing that he doesn't like to do, which was get out in front of something and be emphatic and forceful and say it's going to get fixed, it's going to get done, and he walked right out the door. I still have some questions, but overall point of view, Willie?
In one day, he addressed all three of the scandals that are plaguing the White House. He released emails on Benghazi. He accepted the resignation of the acting head of the IRS, and he called for a media shield law regarding this AP story. So he finally personally encountered all three of those and took action.
He took action. Mika feels good about it. You see? And that coupled with Chuck Todd, NBC News White House correspondent, that the Republicans better watch it here. If you read Politico, it says the Republicans are in danger here. That's their line now. Republicans better not overreach. You don't want to overreach. You don't want to overstep because you'll alienate the public, just like in 1998 with Clinton. Absolutely no analogy. No analogy. Clinton was about, you know, lying about sex, but nonetheless, as I've said, I felt it was legitimate impeachment. He perjured himself to a federal grand jury. That's impeachable. But the country was divided on that, on whether or not it was impeachable. This IRS abuse, going after reporters' records in an unprecedented fashion, Benghazi cover-up, public's not going to be too sympathetic towards this administration. They will welcome the truth. They will welcome the seekers of the truth. So, but the media is trying, and now Mika Brzezinski saying, oh, what did I tell you when I left here the day before, 2 days ago? I said he's going to fire someone at the IRS. That was an hour before they dumped the 100 Benghazi emails. So I said, the media is going to say, see, look what's happening here. Just released some emails on Benghazi. He's going to fire someone at the IRS. They're going to claim, see, he's addressing the scandals. And that's exactly what they're doing. But notwithstanding all that, this is going to get ugly. Ugly. We're going to find out much more here. You can't convince me that the president, if the president of the United States did not know about this audit until last Friday, if the president of the United States did not know anything about what the IRS was doing when you knew about it and I knew about it for years, then if that's what he's claiming, either he's a liar or he doesn't deserve to be president because he's incompetent and he's so out of the loop and so detached from his position that what the heck is he doing? So it's going to get very interesting. Now, let's put that aside for now. I don't want to sound like I'm picking on the poor White House, but, you know, we're still in the middle of sequestration. Yeah. Well, as part of their in-performance at the White House, that whole series, the President and First Lady, they'll be hosting a concert in the East Room honoring Carole King, who will be awarded with the 2013 Library of Congress Gershwin Prize for Popular Song. President Obama will present the award, as he did when the Library of Congress honored Stevie Wonder in 09, Paul McCartney in 2010, Burt Bacharach and Hal David in 2012. The program will include performances by King, Gloria Estefan, Billy Joel, Jesse McCartney, Emilie Sande, James Taylor, and Trisha Yearwood. It will take place starting at 7 o'clock. It doesn't say when. Stream live at 7. And will be broadcast Tuesday, May 28th at 8. Maybe it's tonight. Is this tonight? No. No, this next week. It doesn't say when. Maybe I'm just not reading it right. But next week. Oh. Wednesday, May 22nd. So the president's going to party with Billy Joel and Carole King and James Taylor. That's right. But we got no money. Sequestration. Remember? It's wonderful to be king, isn't it? Anthony Weiner's wife, you know, the one that he apologized to, the one he cried about. How could he have done this to Uma? How could he have done any of this to Uma? All he cared about was Uma. Uma Abedin. Hillary Clinton's whatever. Assistant, top-notch assistant, whatever. What's her title? Whatever. She's just tied at the hip to Hillary. Always has been. Well, the New York Times reports that Weiner's wife, say that five times fast. Hey, you know, yesterday in the show, I actually said Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. I did the whole thing because it said in the whatever I was reading said pickled peppers. Anyway, Weiner's wife did not disclose consulting work that she did while serving in the State Department. By Raymond Hernandez, the State Department, under Secretary Hillary Rodham Clinton, created an arrangement for her longtime aide and confidant. So that's what she is, aide and a confidant. Thank you for being a friend. Uma Abedin, they created an arrangement for Uma Abedin to work for private clients as a consultant while serving as a top advisor to the department. Ms. Abedin did not disclose the arrangement or how much income she earned on her financial report. It requires officials to make public any significant source of income. An advisor to Ms. Clinton, Felipe Reyes, said Ms. Abedin was not obligated to do so. The disclosure of the agreement that Ms. Abedin made with the State Department comes as her husband looks to run for mayor of New York. Ms. Abedin declined a request for an interview, but the picture that emerges from interviews and records suggests a situation where the lines were blurred, says the New York Times, between Ms. Abedin's work in the high echelons of one of the government's most sensitive executive departments and her role as a Clinton family insider. Did I mention Hillary's name? I'm sorry. Does that mean I'm trying to smear her? How dare I mention Hillary since her confidant is up to shady business here? Now, I don't know if it's not illegal. I'll admit that. It's not illegal. But while continuing her work at the State Department in the latter half of last year, she also worked for Teneo, a strategic consulting firm, which was founded by Doug Band, a former advisor to Bill Clinton. And he's advised corporate clients like Coca-Cola, MF Global, the collapsed firm run by John Corzine, by the way. At the same time, Abedin served as a consultant to the William Jefferson Clinton Foundation and worked in a personal capacity for Mrs. Clinton. This is getting interesting. It's not clear what role Mrs. Clinton played in approving the arrangement. So we'll keep an eye on this. And unfortunately, folks, in the state of Texas, Houston Dr. Douglas Carpin is accused by four former employees of delivering live fetuses, those are babies, during third trimester abortions and killing them, either by snipping their spinal cord, stabbing a surgical instrument into their heads, or, quote, twisting their heads off their necks with his own bare hands. End quote. We will have much more on this. Why do I think this happens much more often than we could ever imagine? Baby killers posing as doctors. Have a great weekend, everybody. And thank you for being there on the Steve Malzberg Show.
The Steve Malzberg Show.